We've seen versions of this picture, but not exactly this picture. So this is based on Saez and Piketty's work. When Piketty wrote the book, people really focused on the 1%, what was going on with the share of the income of the 1%. And you know what that discussion is about, but that's not only, but the picture I chose here is not what's going on with the share that goes to the top 1%. It's actually the share that goes to the top 10%. So this is interesting because it's very similar to what actually happens with the top 1%. But I think in terms of economic policy, in terms of economic policy, might be much more interesting to actually look at what's going on with the top 10% versus the top 1%. When I was reading about all of this reaction to Piketty's work in the press, I always thought that the reason why they were talking about the top 1% and not the top 10%, not the top 20%, is because if they included the top 10%, most New York Times journalists would be in the top 10%. So they say, oh, you should protest against us, and because we're making, we're getting a larger share. But it's not new to some extent, the dynamics of the inequality in income. I think that what's really new about it is that they actually were able to look at administrative records, which we believe are far more inclusive of many different income groups. So for many years when I was actually, from the time that I was a student at the University of Chicago to basically this day, there are basically few theories that people have looked at in order to try to understand why this income inequality has increased. I'm going to focus on one theory. So the basic idea here, I'm going to ask you to remind me of one thing. Every time that I show graphs, I might forget what I have in the x-axis and the y-axis. I might forget to tell you. So if you see me describing a graph and not you have no idea what's in the axis, please stop me. It's just that sometimes I forget things. So here is this is a very simple graph. So what I have here in the x-axis is going to be the relative stocks of skills. So I am dividing the stock of skilled worker by the stock of unskilled worker. Now, in the literature, a lot of people would call skilled worker individuals that actually have at least a college degree or more. An unskilled worker, everyone that does not have a college degree, at least a college degree. Okay? And then in the y-axis, what I'm going to have is the relative prices of these skills. So it's going to be the price of skilled labor divided by the price of unskilled labor. Now, don't pay attention to the units. The units here doesn't really, this is just like a description of what this theory, of what two competing theories could be, but they're competing but not mutually exclusive. Okay, so if you look at from basically the 1940s to the 1970s, what you would see is something along the lines that, along the following lines, that this is the relative demand for skilled labor. This is the relative supply of skilled labor. But from the 1940s to the 1970s, things were really stable, as you can see here from this picture. So people believe that at this point in time, the demand, the relative demand and the relative supply were growing about the same rate. Okay? So if they were growing about the same rate, what you would see is that the relative skill price would be constant over time. Okay? The debate is what explains this run up here from basically that starts in the 1980 to what we see to these days. Okay? So there are two theories. One theory is going to say, what's really going on is that the supply of skilled labor, the relative supply of skilled labor, has continued to grow exactly at the same rate as before. But the relative demand for skilled labor, because of technological advances, people are thinking computing, people are thinking TI technology, technology of information advances. What's going to happen is the demand for these guys is going to increase at a much faster rate than than the supply. Okay, so they were growing from 40s to 70s, they were growing exactly the same rate. The 1980s, the demand for this type of work has actually, for the demand for relative skilled labor has started to grow at a faster rate. They call it the skill bias technical change. That's how you're going to see this referred to in the theory. And as you can see, if this story is true, then it's got to be the case that the relative prices of skilled labor actually have to go up over time. So that would be a story that's consistent with what people are saying. Okay. Another story that is consistent, though, is the story in which the demand for skilled labor has not changed the rate according to which it grows since the 1980s, but it's really that the supply of skilled labor has started to grow at a slower rate. And then if you actually plot the consequences of this story is that you're also going to see that this is going to lead to an increase in skill prices. Okay, so these are two stories. They're not mutually exclusive. It's possible that the demand for skilled labor has started to grow at a faster rate in comparison to the 1940s to 1970s period. It's also possible that that the supply of skilled labor actually has slowed down in terms of from 1980s to the present in comparison to 1940s to 1970s. And if you look at a lot of work, and Chris has done some of this work as well, there is some evidence to back up the story that it's the supply of labor, skilled labor, that has started to grow at a lower rate. So if you look at, this is a picture from Godin and Katz book published in 2007. So they went back to the census records, and they started looking at college graduation rates according to the birth year or the birth cohort. And people that were born in the towards the end of the 19th century, not many of them were actually going to college, as you know. There was about a constant growth rate. If you look at this, this looks like the beginning of an exponential curve. Then suddenly things seem to grow at a faster rate for the population that was born between 1920s to 1950s. And then things become a little bit murky, strange. So for the males, what we've seen is some fluctuation. So first it decays, then it goes up again. Then for the females, it continues to go up. So people talk a lot about the female surpassing the males in graduation rates in college. I think that's quite an interesting event. But really what this is for some reason, the males didn't continue to grow, to go to college at the same rate as before, right? So this is a story that there is an increase in a supply of skilled labor. This increase is steady, but at a low rate. Then it increases at a faster rate, and then it decreases at a slower rate, partly because of what's going on for the male population. So that would be consistent with this story that it's not so much the demand, it's more a story on the supply side, okay? But it's not inconsistent. Now, this is not a phenomenon that is occurring all over the world, okay? So this slowing down of supply of skilled labor, it's not going on in every country in the world. So this is really interesting. So if you look at, this is a study done by the OECD. So if you look at the population, this is sometime in 2005 that they did this study. But if you look at the US, the population of 55 to 64 years old, here's the US. About 40% of them were going to college. You had Israel at a time that had a higher rate of people going to college. You had Ireland, you had the Russian Federation, then you had basically Canada at about the same level. But very few countries were above the US in terms of college graduation rates for the 55 to 64 year olds. Okay, almost every other country in the world was actually below the US for that cohort. So what happens for the cohorts of 25 to 34 year olds? So what you see is, look at Korea. Look at what goes on with Korea. What's super interesting to me is that the US was about twice the average of OECD Now it's about the average of OECD. So that's telling you that this is not a phenomenon. This slowdown of the supply of relative skilled labor is not a story that is happening for all countries in the world. It's happening primarily in the United States. Okay. And what's really fascinating is a lot of people have actually looked at, you know, what is the elasticity of substitution between skilled labor and unskilled labor? So how easy it is to replace an unskilled labor with unskilled worker with a skilled worker, or the other way around. So we have lots of estimates for those things. It turns out that there is some complementarity, so it's not so easy to replace one with the other. But if you plug down, if you plug what the numbers, this elasticity of substitution and the shares of each one of these types of labor in, I don't want to check online. It's nothing for me to check online at this point. So you can predict what the skill premium is going to be relative to what the skill premium is just by using what the relative the relative ratios in the data that you see. And what you're going to be able to do is you're going to be able to track a lot of the inequality that people have documented in terms of skilled and unskilled labor. So even without any story, even without needing any story of skill bias technical change. So lesson number one is that inequality has been increasing. It seems to be the case that the inequality is increasing because one reason is because in the US, the growth rate of skilled labor has actually been reducing over time. Okay, so for some reason, we are failing to produce human capital or increasing the production of human capital at the same level as before. So a few years ago, with Heckman and Navarro, we were interested in finding out, okay, so how much of, so you have all of this is inequality in lifetime income. So this is, if you go to the NLSY and you look at people's incomes from basically age 25, I think that we followed them up to age 45. This is the distribution you're going to see in the data. What we wanted to see is, okay, so what if we took out any component that is either observed or known by the agent? And to understand what is known by the agent, you actually have to understand how agents select into different markets, because you always make choices based on what you know, hopefully. You never make choices based on what you don't know, right? So if I can correlate outcomes of the choices associated with the choices that you made and the choices that you made, I can actually back out what the information set of the agent is. So now this exercise here is, let's take out things that we observe about agents, and let's take out things that the agents know about themselves, but we don't actually observe directly. And what you actually see is that this inequality, this entire inequality, the variance of this inequality here, actually gets reduced by close to 50%, which seems to indicate that a lot of the inequality that we see is not because of shocks that happen when individuals are actually in the labor market already. It's something to do with the human capital that they have accumulated even before they join the labor market. Okay, so a lot of people now are actually doing a lot more work on this topic, trying to estimate information sets of agents, precisely because they want to find out how much of inequality is actually already present even before people enter the labor market and we start seeing the consequences of this inequality. Okay, so Heckman and Sergio Sua and Jory Stixrud wrote a paper a few years ago trying to document how much of this inequality is due to either cognitive skills, which are, you know, things like how well you do in standardized tests that that are applied almost everywhere. So, for example, a good measure of a cognitive test would be Raven's progressive matrices tests. So these are those tests that they show you five pictures and they ask you what is the sixth picture should be, and then they give you five options. You know, that test takes 2 hours. And when I was in the job market, I decided to take that test because I was afraid that people would ask me, you know, what is a cognitive test? It took me 2 hours, and then I realized this is like the best non-cognitive test that I have ever taken in my life, because to maintain your attention for 2 hours is like fantastic, right? So, but in any case, people, it's very interesting because there is a huge literature nowadays about saying, can you actually get people to do better in a test like the Raven's Progressive Matrix by paying them according to their performance? And you can actually improve some people's skills or some people's performance on a cognitive test just by paying them, which actually is quite interesting. And the people that actually get really rewarded, that get really affected by payment conditioned on performance, are individuals that actually have very low conscientiousness. So they are very low on some non-cognitive test. This conscientiousness means, you know, you really will do what you're expected to do. So, you know, you're going to work hard, you're going to be disciplined, you're going to do things according to, you know, the book and so on and so forth. So if you are high IQ, low conscientiousness, you're going to score really low on an IQ test. But if I pay you, you're going to do really, really well because you're smart. You just needed the right reward to actually do this. Now, socio-emotional skills here, in this study, is really measured as one of the ways is a test known as locus of control. So locus of control is how much you believe that what happens, how much of the events that happen to you, so for example, you get a promotion. Do you believe that you got a promotion just because there was some random shock out there, someone, you know, got hired, they didn't have anyone to replace that person, and oh, you were the first one that they saw, oh yeah, sure, you're going to be the one? Or is it the result of working hard and so on and so forth? This is one of the ways that they measure socio-emotional tests. Now, a lot of people in the 1960s and 1970s were crazy about these types of tests, because the theory back then, people had this theory that there were people had different types of needs, so there is need for power. People that have need for power will try to become dictators. The people that have need for money, they try to become billionaires. You know, and then there were all these psychologists trying to explain, you know, the reason why some countries are rich because they had a lot of people that had a lot of need for money. The reason why some countries had a lot of dictators is that they had a lot of people that had like need for power and so on and so forth. So the locus of control test goes back all these years, but it has been refined in terms of what is it, do you have control over the things that happen to you, or you think that the things that happen to you because of some random shock, okay? And so what's interesting about this is if you look at log wages at a certain age, at age 30, and you condition on age 30, or age 35, or age 40, what you're going to see is that this is the deciles of cognitive skills. So one is low, 10 is high. The same thing goes here, decile of socio-emotional skills. One is low, 10 is high. So as people move from the decile, from the bottom of the decile, so from the bottom of distribution of cognitive skills to the top of the distribution of cognitive skills, wages go up. Doesn't seem to be like a lot, but it's like 0.5 log points. So it's some respectful number. And the same thing is you're going to see as people go from the bottom of the distribution of socio-emotional skills to the top of distribution of socio-emotional skills. What's really interesting, though, is now we have more evidence on this. If you actually account for the fact that wages are partly the result of accumulated experience on the job training, for example, or learning by doing, then what you're going to see is accumulated experience is really greatly influenced by this by socio-emotional skills, much more than cognitive skills. And as a result, if I were to plot not condition, if they were to not condition on some version of accumulated experience, they would actually see that socio-emotional skills would actually be even more powerful than it is right now. Okay, so dropping out from school, exactly the same story. As people move from the bottom of distribution of cognitive skills to the top, increases the probability of graduating from secondary school, from high school. The same thing you're going to see for socio-emotional skills. Enrollment into college. This is not only this is not graduation from college, it's just enrollment. And again, what you're going to see is as you move from the bottom of the decile of cognitive skills, more likely to graduate, more likely to enroll into college. The same thing you're going to see for socio-emotional skills. Okay, and graduating from college versus stopping after a few years in college but not graduating from college. And smoking, which is going to translate into health, which is another dimension of human capital. And even participation in elections. It's greatly influenced by cognitive and socio-emotional skills. And whether you have a white-collar occupation or not, greatly influenced by both socio-emotional and cognitive skills. Whether people are going to go to jail, this is super interesting because most of the action actually happens if you move from the bottom of the distribution of non-cognitive skills to the top of the distribution, to not so the bottom, but kind of the middle of the distribution of socio-emotional skills. And by the way, what's really interesting about this is they measure these skills at age 15, then they follow people by age 30. So this is, it's not that I went to jail and then people are treating me badly in jail, and as a result, I'm going to have horrible non-cognitive skills, because horrible non-cognitive skills is what actually I need in order to survive in jail. You know, if you put me in jail and I'm going to be a nice guy, I'll probably not last 2 days there. So I actually need to develop bad non-cognitive skills. We're going to talk a little bit about what this means in a second. Okay. So, but this is not what's going on. This is really measuring non-cognitive skills when individuals are 15 years old. Then look at what happened to them when they are 30 years old. So. And teenage pregnancy, the same story. People move, as individuals move from the bottom to the top of distributions of cognitive and social emotional skills, what you see is actually that they're going to do better in that outcome as well.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure, but stop me anytime, ask as many questions as you want. Happy to go. You know, you should see this slide as like a suggestion of a talk that, now, if you see, this is boring, can we talk about something else? Yes.
It's still not clear to me, how do you measure social-emotional skills, and how do you guarantee that they are not correlated with cognitive skills?
Oh, great question. So, so socio-emotional skills, one of the measures is locus of control. So they literally give them a questionnaire, and they ask, and they literally ask you, you know, do you believe that events happen to you? The questions are formulated in a way that there are two answers. Are you more likely to believe that things that happen to you are the result of random shocks that you don't have control over, or some actions that you took in the past that led to that result? Okay, that's one component. Another component of the socio-emotional skill, of the measurement of socio-emotional skills in these studies here, is it's a self-esteem scale, which really is a great indicator of whether people are depressed or not. Okay, but it's not what a lot of people would think of socio-emotional skills, because a lot of people nowadays would think of socio-emotional skills in terms of the big five: openness to new experiences, extroversion, neuroticism, agreeableness, and conscientiousness. It's not that. I'll talk a little bit more about measurement of skills later in my talk. I'm going to come back and tell you, you know, there are a lot of issues here. The reason why, so by construction, these guys are not very correlated. And the reason is, when psychologists that study socio-emotional skills, they want to construct a measurement of socio-emotional skills that are uncorrelated with cognitive skills. Okay. So if they actually, it's very interesting, if they propose a construct, a socio-emotional construct, they then propose a measurement, and if they see, and then they go to the field and collect data. And when they collect the data, they collect data not only on the construct that they want, but on a lot of other constructs as well, to make sure that the construct that they have is actually new. So if they were to determine in this field experiment, the first field experiment that they saw, that there were questions that were highly correlated with cognitive skills or any other construct that is not the construct of interest, they would eliminate those questions from these scales. Okay? So this is why it's by construction. We, as economists, I don't know if I like this or not, because I prefer if you give me a new construct and it turns out that this new construct is completely correlated with cognitive skills, for me it's really valuable to see that this is just a different way of measuring cognitive skills. But in any way, this is how this is operating in the field. Now, that's how it goes, okay? So this is, the pictures that I showed you are pictures from the NLSY 79. The pictures that I'm going to show to you from now on, most of them come from the children of the NLSY. So these are the children of the females in the NLSY. So they have been following this for these kids since 1986. And every 2 years, they go back and measure cognitive skills, socio-emotional skills, health, and so on and so forth. So what I did was, here in this picture is, let's divide the NLSY females into four groups according to their income. So top income, highest income, this is the poorest families. And that, let's now look at what happens with their children as they age in terms of development, cognitive development, socio-emotional development. Okay. So what you're going to see is the gap between the top and the bottom quartile at age 14 in a cognitive skill. In this case here, it's one numeracy test, is about one standard deviation, okay, at age 14. This is the, what's interesting about this is, it is about at age 15 that we measure the skills of the parents and we predict what's gonna happen, and we see the predictive value of the differences in skills on real outcomes of interest, income, white collar occupation, going to jail or not going to jail, teenage pregnancy, so on and so forth. And I showed to you that cognitive skills really important in that dimension. Already at age 14, there is one standard deviation between high and low income kids. What's, you go back to age 5, this is right before they actually enter school, and the difference is 0.8 standard deviations. So a lot of the differences in development that we're going to measure at age 14 are already present at age 5. And then at age 3, they're not so big. One important question that arises here is how easy it is to measure child development at age 3. So if you've seen a 3-year-old running around and you ask the 3-year-old, let's have some test, the 3-year-old may or may not comply with your request. It's really a challenge. So a lot of people question, is this opening up from age 3 to 5, is it really real, or is just difficulty in measurement? Because if there is pure measurement error, if it's all measurement error, we should see that this is going to be actually just equal, because there would be no information on these tests, right? So unfortunately, this is not only measurement error. So this is another study that was done by two developmental psychologists in the 1980s. This was super interesting, extremely, it was a lot of work. It took them almost 10 years to collect the data, clean all the data. And the reason is, they started a study when kids were 9 months old. 42 kids were 9 months old. And they basically, once a month, they sent a research assistant to the home with a tape recorder to follow the child around, okay? And then they brought the tape recorder back to the lab, transcribed everything that happened in the home during that 1 hour, okay? So it's really interesting because this is like one of the very first studies to actually document language development across different socioeconomic groups. And what they did is, every month that they went back, For each child, they created an Excel spreadsheet, what would look like an Excel spreadsheet, and the columns, sorry, on the rows of this Excel spreadsheet were the words that the child had spoken at every point in time, and the columns were the ages. So they just counted the number of different words that the children had spoken at different points in time. They're not counting, if they say car, 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 they're saying it's one word. They're not saying it's three words, okay? So it's not a number, it's not counting the number of times that they said a word, it's literally counting the different number of words that children actually had spoken, already spoken at different points in time. This is not all the words that these children knew, because this is only expressive language. It doesn't capture receptive language. So there are many words that Chris tells me, I understand them. You'll never hear me say those words. But that's part of my vocabulary. Okay. So no, and they are nice words. Before, you know, Chris is a very polite person. So, but in any case, what you're going to see is, yeah, at age 10 months, you don't see children speaking many different words. You don't see 10-month-old children saying heteroscedasticity. You're not gonna see that, right? But you know, it's fantastic. They have a lot of vocalization. You know, you go to a clinic and you sit near a mom and the child says, ma, 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 and the mom says, no cookie for you right now. And I'm like, really? but in any case, no word that a research assistant would say, this is a recognizable word, okay? So all children were about here. Now, don't get fooled by this. Huge differences in vocalization, I'll show to you even at age 9 months. Huge differences in vocalization. So some children are vocalizing a lot, other children are not vocalizing almost ever. Okay, I'm gonna show something about this. Then over time, obviously, children start expressing language. And what you're going to see is this this difference in number of words that were ever recorded. So by 36 months, the children of the six welfare family, they actually had the vocabulary of the children from the professional parents at 24 months, which indicates at age 36 months, they already had 1 year of developmental delay, at least in expressive language, okay? So this is showing it's difficult to measure child development at age 3, but we don't think that the differences that we see are, there might be some measurement error, but there are some real differences out there, okay? If you look at socio-emotional skills, so this is a little bit more, socio-emotional skills have always been a little bit more difficult to measure. Nowadays, people are making progress on this front. There is a lot of research in this area. But in the CNLSY, it's really interesting because the only way that they measure socio-emotional skills is by asking parents to report what type of child your child is. So is it a child that is shy, doesn't talk to other people in class, in their classroom, or is it a child that interacts more with other children at the same age? How do the children react? How does your child react when an adult talks to your child? So what type of reaction does the child have when the child is frustrated? Is it a child that internalizes, suffers? Is it a child that starts yelling, so on and so forth? So parents actually have to report those types of skills. And a lot of developmental psychologists would be worried about parental reports precisely because this wouldn't be a standardized report, right? So if a child lives in a very dangerous environment, it's natural that the child will feel more introvert, not so much outgoing, and so on and so forth. So you would like to standardize at least the setting in which the measurement is occurring. But in any case, what you see, again, this is the opposite now, because this is antisocial behavior. So research on antisocial behavior goes back a long time. A lot of people interested in criminal behavior actually looked at antisocial behavior at very early ages. Seems to be a group of children who end up as criminals that at very young ages, they actually are highly antisocial. it's not that every child that is antisocial will become a criminal, but there is a group of children and they don't know exactly what the story is yet. But here the idea is that the lower your score, the better it's going to be. Just a second, I'll come back to you. And what you and the higher your score, the more antisocial you're going to be, so you don't want to be antisocial. And again, what you see is from age 4 to age 12 years, you see these parallel trends in socio-emotional development across socio-economic groups. Yeah, go ahead. It's entirely asked by parents. So they really ask parents, how does your child react when an adult, a strange, asks your child a question? How does your child react when a person the same age, a child of the same age, approaches your child and so on and so forth? So it's entirely asked directly to parents based on parental report. Now, a lot of people, once they go into school, a lot of people start also asking teachers to see what the behaviors are going to be. There is some correlation between what parents say and what teachers say. Correlation is far from perfect. A lot of people believe that this is because of report, right? So if you were to ask my mother this question, right? Well, you know, question about conscientiousness. Is Flavio conscientious? My mom would probably say no. I think I'm very conscientious, but her reference group was probably my brother and my sister, who are really much more conscientious than I am. So she's thinking, oh, I have these really two conscientious children, and I have this other one that is not very conscientious. So Flav is not conscientious, right? So it's the reference group bias, right? So it's very interesting because there are a lot of work on this topic. Educational testing services is actually, I'm going to show some of the research that they're doing. They're really worried about this because it's very fascinating. If you go across, for example, across units of observation, you might actually get the right type of correlation in the following sense. You might find that conscientious children actually do better than non-conscientious children once you account for, you know, yeah, my sister and my brother have done much better than I have. And if you ask my mother, it's no surprise. But as you go across households, it might be the case that you might find a negative correlation between conscientiousness and success just because of this reference group bias. I'll show you a little bit more about this. Education testing services really worried about this. A lot of people are telling them, oh, you know, you need to use socio-emotional skills. You need to measure socio-emotional skills on top of SAT. Turns out that there is a challenge of doing that. Reference group bias is going to be one of these challenges. Okay.
It is health. Study by Case Lobotsky and Paxson. It's a little bit different.
The way that they present the picture is a little bit different from the way you are presenting the pictures. Because here what they're going to have, the x-axis what they're going to have is the log of the family income. Here they're going to have, and again, this is reported by the parents, okay? So this is health status as reported by the parents. 1 is excellent, 5 is poor. So you want to be low on this scale here. Okay, so this is the gap. So if you look at age 0 to 3, it's this first curve here. So high income children, they are below 1.5 in this score that goes from 1 to 5. Low income children are above 2. Okay, but so this gap at age 0 to 3 is already huge. And clearly, as children age, the gradient is becoming steeper, which means that the differences in health accumulation are increasing over time. But most of the gap, if you look at the gap between 13 and 17, this guy here versus this guy, this is about twice. The gap is about twice in health in this strange scale. But most of the gap is already present before age 3. Okay, so I don't want to say, there's one thing that I, from the outside, I don't want you to think that all that we need to do is to equalize health at age 0 to 3. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, what are you going to see if you see that children are receiving low investments from age 0 to 3, it's likely that they are also going to receive low investments from then on. So inequality is going to be an inequality in investments throughout the lifetime. It's not going to start when they are about to go to college. It actually starts even before they are born, and it's going to continue. And if you want to change this, it's going to be cheaper to start changing this early on. But it's not changing early and not doing anything late. It's not giving them really great early development, early childhood development, and sending them to horrible schools. We're going to talk a little bit more about this. Okay, so don't, yeah, I mean, it's worth, so you're going to see many times people saying, we just need to get children ready to school and that's going to be okay. No, because some children are going to horrible schools, other children are going to go to great schools. And if you fix things at age 6, but you don't, you know, fix things at later ages, probably things are going to continue to be unequal for a long time, okay? And so what is producing this inequality in skills? So there is very few ways to measure investments in a home. One of them is called the home observation for the measurement of the environment, which is home. So it's very strange. It's a very good acronym. It's a very old thing. The development of this home started by researchers in the 1960s, but they didn't publish the results until the 1970s. And it's an index which makes economists really worried about. So here, what I've done here for comparison is just to have again the four groups: bottom quartile of permanent income. Top quartile of permanent income is the curve up there. And what you're going to see is the difference that is already present at age 0. But you see that the difference is quite stable over time. So equating just this part of the graph here, not equating what happens later, probably will not solve the issue of inequality. Okay? So this is one way that individuals measure home. I'm going to show you specific components of the home in a second to show how these things actually, the differences. So here's Hart and Risley. So Hart and Risley had, their thesis was that language development was really induced by the quality of the language environment children experienced on a day-to-day lives, their day-to-day lives. What's really interesting, so, and then the way that they operationalized this is by counting the number of words addressed to the child in the space of an hour, okay? Now, I want you to think that this is 1 hour of the day in a month. It's usually the high talking time of the day because the research assistant chose to go at a time in which adults would be at home and likely to be interacting with the child, okay? So the Hart and Risley study is a study that oversamples talking to the child, okay? And this was by design. Okay. So this is not number of different words. This is, if I say car, 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 it's 5 times car. Okay. So it's really the number of words addressed to the child, regardless of the variability of the words that I actually used. So a lot of measurement error here, right? Because on one day, some people are going to talk more than others, you know? So what they're going to do is they're going to average this over periods of time, 3 months for every child. Then they're going to follow these children around. So here are the 6 welfare children. These are their ages. This is the number of words addressed to the child. Now, I'm speaking to you at a rate of about 300 words per minute. Okay? These children here are hearing 750 words per hour at a high talking time of the day. Okay? So it's less than 3 minutes of my conversation to you. Quite stable. The high SES children, what's going on there is that they're already starting at about twice as many words per hour. But you see that it's increasing over time? Okay, so this increase over time, you know what's driving it? It's a conversation that is initiated by the child. Okay? So if the child gets better language development, the child will actually start more conversations because the child will start asking more questions. At some point, they become those creatures that ask why. Why, right? It's almost automatic. Why, right? I said, why, right? So this is what's driving this difference. And the other reason that this is being driven is because the parents are not ever responding yes or no to the child's question. So the child asks, are we gonna go out? The parents then say yes. No, they say, do you think we're gonna go out? And the child says, yeah, I think we're gonna go out. And then the parent asks, why? Well, because you're putting, you know, your shoes and say, oh, great, it's right. I think we're gonna go out. Wanna go out? Yes. You wanna wear some clothes? Yes. So what do you want to wear? Wear a jacket. Well, but you have two jackets. You have the green jacket and you have the blue jacket. You know, in that so if you read the Hart and Risley book, what's really interesting about this is that they have these passages in which parents transform really, you know, like trivial experiences into extremely rich language interaction between adult and child. But if you read the parts that come from the welfare parents, what you're going to see a lot is shut up, don't say anything right now. Okay, so if the child asks a question, it's only a short yes or no answer. So that doesn't give a lot of room for the child to continue the conversation. Okay, so a lot of research nowadays on trying to see why is it that these parents are responding this fashion to the kids, okay? It might be optimal for the parents to do that because of the environment in which they are, okay? So we're gonna talk a little bit more about this. Go ahead.
Sorry, I have a question. So, worse, I don't know if there were studies that like even if you take kids from low income families and then you talk to them as much, like are they gonna be the same as kids from high-income families, you said that there are other factors, right?
Yeah.
Because if I always feel threatened, even if you talk to me a lot, it's not like I'm going to talk as much.
Yeah, so there are some studies that are being done right now in which, Meredith Rowe went back and redid the Hart and Risley study about 10 years ago. This time she used videos because not only she wanted to understand the audio, she also wanted to understand, you know, what is the context, right? Okay. And she basically reproduced this finding from the Hart and Risley study. Basically, if you look at the paper, there are very few differences, but most of the qualitative and quantitative findings are there. At the end of the study, she went back and she asked parents that were talking too little to the children, why are you talking so little to your child? The model answer by far was, why should I talk more? There is no reason for me to talk to the child. The child doesn't understand half of the things that I tell her or him. So people, if you walk like 3 blocks from here, you're gonna meet a physician, Dana Susskind, who is going on doing this home visitation program where she basically tells parents about brain development, well, language development and the brain. Okay, so what part of, you know, the language development really depends on the environment that children experience. And she gives them this information. The other thing that she does is she actually measures the quality of the language environment and tells them, oh, here's your score on this measure of language environment. This was yours. Your score last week was this, so improved. Do you think that you can improve more? So she's done a few randomized controlled trials. She's found out that you can influence parental behavior by telling them how language development happens, by giving them feedback about how well they're doing. And what's really interesting is you can actually measure language development in children. You see that they actually also improve language development as well. Okay, so right now, there are a lot of places that are doing this type of research. So the Providence, Rhode Island has Providence Talks. I don't know if you've heard about this, but it's the entire city initiative now, trying to get parents, low-income parents, to actually talk more to children. So we're gonna know 3-4 years from now, we're gonna have like 20 papers being published in American Economic Review following the work that Hart and Risley did, but this time with a randomized controlled trial. Can we influence language development? Does it mean that if I influence language development, will the children do better in school? Okay, so on and so forth. But it's ongoing work. I'm not going to talk much about this. You can measure inequality. I've shown to you pictures of differences, mean differences. Here's one picture that captures the entire differences in distribution of investments. So this is based on the PSID. The PSID has a very interesting measurement of child of investments in children, which is a time diary for each child. So you know for each child what is the activity that the child was doing, and you know for each child who was present when the child was doing that activity, and you know where the child was. Okay, so it's really detailed data. A lot of people have been using it for a lot of research. This is the distribution of time of quality interaction between a child and the mother between ages 0 to 2. I'm focusing on the group of 0 to 2 because what you're going to see over time is this negative trend. As children age, parents tend to spend less time with children, basically because children need less attention. So this is why I'm focusing only on age 0 to 2. This is the distribution for a low-income group. This is the distribution for high-income group. What is really interesting is that, yeah, there is a difference in the means and the modes of this distribution, but there is a huge overlap as well. So there are low-income families that invest a lot, and there are high-income families that don't actually invest that much, at least not directly through the mother. Okay, so mean differences exist, but there is huge variability around the mean as well, so it's important to keep that in mind. Okay, so not only there are these differences in means, but the differences in means follow a very interesting pattern. So at different ages, children really develop different types of skills, which means that the type of interactions that you want to have with the child is different at different ages, right? So at age 0 to 2, really it's about bonding with the child, establishing connection with the child, right? Making the child feel nurtured, emotionally secure, so on and so forth, okay? So what type of activities lead to that development? Well, playing with the child, you know, peekaboo, you know, like, it's fantastic. I know it sounds crazy, right? That this would be like investment. For you, it's not investment if I do this with you, clearly, right? But for a child, singing with the child, making the child feel secure, loved, attended to, is really important for the development of a socially, emotionally secure child. Okay, so this is minutes in these types of play with the child. If you look at the gap between high and low SES groups, it's not that the gap in play is large at age 6 to 13, not 3 to 5, it's actually the greatest the gap is at age 0 to 2, exactly at the time that the child needs that type of interaction. Okay, so it's not so much that they're spending less time. They're spending less time in activities that are actually important for child development at the age that the child is. So at age 3 to 5, it's about getting the child ready to school. So it's when you start, yeah, go ahead.
So is your best educational attainment of the parents?
This is going to be, yeah, the parental education attainment, yeah. So this is, again, the PSID data. Okay, so it's exactly the same data that I showed before, but Ariel Khalil and her colleagues didn't break this down in permanent income. They broke this down into a parental educational background, which is highly correlated with permanent income anyway. Okay, so if you were to do this with permanent income, my guess is that it wouldn't be too different. But yeah, thank you. So see, here I am explaining pictures without explaining what's in the picture. I told you, help me. Thank you. So at age 3 to 5 is about getting children ready to go to school. So you're going to teach them colors and numbers and shapes and sizes. letters of the alphabet, counting with them, so on and so forth. This is the type of activity that happens. There is a huge industry of home visitation programs done all over the United States and all over the world, trying to get parents to do that.
Yeah. So is this an experience with the mother and father, or is it just...
It's an adult in the... Yeah, this is really, in their study, is an adult. It could be the mother or the father, okay? Or the grandmother. Yes, thank you. Yeah, girls get a lot more attention than boys. Yes, so, yeah.
So is it, so the difference in minutes, is it due to the fact that people with higher education have more time, or because they are more aware of the fact that this is useful for the child?
We don't know. So this is my current research nowadays, trying to document, do parents know the importance of doing these things? Unfortunately, what I can tell you is that low SES parents really underestimate the importance of interaction for child development, by a factor of 3, actually, yeah. Any other questions that I, yeah, go ahead.
I was wondering, like, if you see differences in kids that have siblings, like, uh-huh. You see siblings sort of like, parents.
Yes, yes, so you actually, this is really interesting. Many different studies. We don't understand exactly what the story is. Some studies, they find that the higher the child's cognitive skills at a past period, the higher the parental investment. Other studies find the opposite. So there are very few people find no differences across siblings within the household according to a child's developmental stage, which leads to a story of is it compensation or is it some form of reinforcement? Okay, there is a the PSID data that Amy Sheen did a few years ago. When she published the paper, she was postdoctoral researcher at the University of Michigan, and what she found was really interesting. This is the PSID study. High SES families tended to do more compensation. Low SES families tended to do more reinforcement. I don't know I think that was the first time that people broke down compensation versus reinforcement stories by socioeconomic groups. I don't know if this is a story still is stable or not, but it's clearly an area of research that a lot of people are trying to do more of. Yeah, any other questions? Yeah, go ahead.
Isn't necessarily the case that this is linear, this effect? Time spent, because just anecdotal evidence of last Christmas, I visited my cousin, and she's a child of 2 years old.
Yeah.
She spent a lot of time with her child, and my sister and my mom were kind of worried that this was negatively impact the self-reliance of the child in the future. So is it necessarily the case that this is linear, or it could be there's some kind of U-shape in terms of time spent with the child, in terms of
we don't know. Yeah, good question. Okay, so we don't know much about that. If there is decreasing returns, there might be. Okay, so I'm going to tell you about estimation of production functions in a second. One of the assumptions there was that there was some constant return to scale. This is an assumption that was made in the estimation. So we didn't even anticipate the issue of trying to look at decreasing return to scale or not. Okay. But this view, see, this is so interesting because anthropologists in the 1960s, they really thought that to understand culture, we need to understand how parents interact with children. Okay. So they had all of these studies that were done with hunter-gatherer societies, and they looked at the way that they were interacting, okay? So they were hunter-gatherer societies that lived in areas that they needed to be mobile, and the parents believed that children, they couldn't foster language development in children, but they could foster motor development in children. So when they measured language development in this context, language development was really poor, but motor development was fantastic. You know, they have these pictures of children who are 2 years old handling knives that are basically the size of the child, right? And you go to, you know, you go here out the street and you get like a University of Chicago professor who has like a 2-year-old child and show this the picture, he's gonna say, oh, it's crazy. And the child can manipulate knives and so on and so forth. The hunter-gatherer societies, like in Paraguay, that they actually don't, they can't be mobile because they're surrounded by jaguars. So you don't want to be, you know, like venturing on a forest. And if you ask the parents, those parents, they're going to say, children can learn a lot about plants, but we should really not teach them how to walk. They can walk, but we should not, because we want them not to be walking around, because they're going to be eaten by a jaguar, okay? If you go to other regions, there is really interesting in which self, every household was an autarky. So they really needed, they were isolated groups. So they really needed to produce everything that they needed to consume, which meant that every member of the household had a very specific task. If you are a child, you're way down in the hierarchy and you need to learn how to actually follow orders. So if you ask the parents, can't teach these children how to actually, we can't teach language, we don't want to teach language. The only language that they need to know is yes. If you tell them, do this, they will say yes. They actually never talk to the child so that the child understood that her job was to follow orders from the adults. Okay, so the view of what parents believe is right is so interesting, because really depends on the context in which they're living. So a lot of my research nowadays is trying to document what does it mean for a production function from the point of view of the parent. So this notion that, you know, interacting too much with the child will lead to the child being not self-reliant, a lot of people actually have those views as well. What we do not know for sure are studies that have randomly selected parents to do. You're going to be like, I want you to be the following kind of parent. Okay, and I want you to be the following kind of parent. And then we get like a million parents to actually sign up to this study with their own children. And then we follow them. That would be like a great... Once you become parents and you want to do this study, let me know. You know, like... But it is, I mean, it's... To some extent, it's really... So when I tell you, I'm gonna show to you how to actually estimate production function of human capital, I want you to have this in mind, because it's super difficult. I'm not going to lie to you. The issue of endogeneity, the issue, you know, the types of investments that parents make. You know, you ask a lot of low SES parents, as Meredith Rowe asked, you know, why do you talk so little to your child? And why do you give so much directives? It's not only that they talk little. It's when they talk, it's more like do this, do that, and so on and so forth. Why? And one of the reasons why the parents actually mentioned to Meredith Rowe is, I live in a really very dangerous neighborhood. If I tell my child, come inside the house right now, I don't want the child to be asking, why? But can't I interact with my friends? I see bullets flying. Maybe I can get on one of them. Okay, so the parents are actually reacting to the kind of environment. So it's super, super difficult separating parental beliefs from environment, from child development. Goes back to the story of how much of this is just because of reinforcement and compensation, so on and so forth. There's a real measurement issue that goes into a lot of what we don't know. Okay, so again, you look at this picture here by Ariel Khalil and Rebecca Ryan and Corey. What you're going to see is the gaps in investments on school readiness are larger precisely at the age that children are learning these school readiness types of skills, okay? And when children are in adolescence, right? So I'm showing here age 6, and you're thinking, well, adolescent, age 6. Actually, it's quite interesting because people have been looking at trying to determine adolescence, okay? So for girls, it's a little bit easy because it's the first time that they actually have a period. For boys, it's a little bit more difficult. The way that people have operationalized this for a long time is by looking at age at which boys are taking away from choir practices. Now there is this age at which boys start to go, their voice start to change, and then they become, right? I mean, if you know some of you in the room know exactly what I'm talking about. It's quite embarrassing, actually. You have no control of your voice. So embarrassing. You can imagine what happens when you're trying to approach someone and people look at it, why are you talking like that? So, what's really interesting is if you look at the age of first period for girls, it has been going down for centuries now. And the age at which boys are removed from choirs also being reduced for centuries now. So it seems to be the case that adolescence is starting earlier and earlier. Okay, and what drives the changes are basically hormonal changes. Okay, here's the problem. Brain development in adolescence is really interesting because the part of the reward, the part of the brain that controls reward, actually is activated as soon as hormones start to act. But we have this part of the brain here that controls our, you know, like our craziness. And that doesn't actually get started to develop once the hormones set in. Actually, that doesn't start to develop until you the late teens, early 20s, okay? So when adolescence began at age 15, and you had only 2 or 3 years of, you know, driving without the seatbelt, which is this part of your brain, that's not so bad. But if adolescence is starting at age 9, 10, and the part of the brain that is going to control the impulses are not developing until age 18, 19, then that means that you're now under more years of danger, right? Because you are reacting so much to the reward, and you're not sensitive to the losses, okay? Which leads to actions by parents. So if you look at what parents are doing to some extent, they are actually managing children. You know, if you are an adolescent and you really care about reward, there is one thing that you don't want to do, homework. There's no reward associated with homework. But if the parents are there to enforce you to do the homework, then some children are going to do the homework, and other children, and if the parents are not there to enforce you to do the homework, they're not going to be doing the same. The other thing that happens here is management is also about driving children to a lot of these extra school assignments. So, you know, you're going to... Soccer was great. I mean, my parents didn't let me do that. I had to learn German, which I forgot. piano, which I forgot. Guitar, which I forgot. And but all of these artistic or culturally enhancing activities. And try to understand why would my parents, for many years, I wanted to play soccer and volleyball. That's what I wanted to do, but they never let me do that, right? But why is it that they were actually trying to do that? Well, it turns out that nowadays, there's some really interesting research out there that adolescents are really sensitive to reward. They're especially sensitive to reward when they are in the presence of other teenagers, other adolescents, right? So there are now these studies that have been done. It's fascinating. It's always done with a video game because you want to, again, standardize the setting according to which this thing actually happens. So Lawrence Steinberg has done a lot of, who is a psychologist at Temple University in Philadelphia. He's got this little video game. It is driving from A to B. So it doesn't, you know, if you play a video game, this is not going to be so interesting because it's not advanced graphics. But what it is driving from A to B, at certain points in time, you're going to see a red traffic sign. You have the choice of respect the red light and stopping or keep going. If you keep going, there's a reward because you may actually arrive at point B faster. But there might be a consequence, which is you may have an accident that is going to delay you. And if you get delayed, there is no way that you're going to win this game. Okay, so super interesting. They ask people who are as young as 7 years old and as old as 70 years old to play this game. And then one of the things that they do is let's see, you know, what's the fraction of times that people are going to not respect the red light. And then it's something like, you know, 7-year-old children, they actually respect more than teenagers. Then, as you know, teenagers are crazy. They're going for the reward. They're not sensitive to the loss. That's what these guys would say. This is what you see. And all as we age, by age 25, there's no difference. 25 to 70, almost no difference whatsoever. Okay. Now the game, then they switch the game a little bit. They say, okay, now you're gonna play the game, but I'm gonna get someone of your same age group to actually see you play the game. Okay, so 7-year-old children, they don't do too different from what they would do. But the adolescents, now they want to show off, right? Because it's about the reward. So it really spikes. Risky behavior really spikes now. By age 25, whether your friend is there or not, doesn't affect your the behavior that you're gonna get. Now you do the same game and now you tell them it's not, so your peer will be watching you play the game, but not in this room. He's gonna be in a different room. And then the same thing happens with the adolescents. It's not that the peer needs to be near the peer, they just need to know that there is a peer watching them. And then they do another one, which is they tell them that there might be a peer. There might be. It's not even clear that there might be a peer, that there is a peer or not. And even though there might only be a peer, it still is enough to get them to behave even more riskier than they were behaving before. Okay? And then what you do, you know what you do then? And then you tell them, okay, so you're gonna do this with the adolescent peer in a room. We're gonna put a couple of adults in the room as well. You know what happens? The adolescents behave as the adolescent would be without a peer. So it seems like for every, if you actually have a lot of adolescents and you start putting adults to in the room, it seems that that seems to get rid of some of the riskiness in the behavior that they have. So then you start looking at what is it that high-income parents do when they can't take care of their children? What is it that they do? So they send them to do like soccer, right? Why soccer? There's going to be a lot of peers, but there's going to be always adults taking care of them. So if you look at extra activities, extracurricular activities that happen post-school, that high SES parents actually choose their children to attend, send their children to attend to, what you're going to see is that it's never an extracurricular activity that is a bunch of teenagers running by themselves. It's always teenagers, but accompanied by adult people. Which the evidence seems to suggest is enough to get them to behave not as risky as they would in similar circumstances. So it's exactly at those ages that we would like to see more management of activities, right? And this is exactly where we see the gap between high and low SES groups should be larger, okay? So this is, right, I mean, clearly at this age, what you don't want to do is sing to them. Right, so I have a colleague that told me that nowadays the singing is more like a menace, right? So if you don't behave well, I'll sing that song that you liked when you were 2 years old in front of your friends. And so keep that in mind. Great way to get children to cooperate, adolescents to cooperate. Okay, so here's what's going on. So this is some of the components of the home now, and this is only the white population, but this is, for every race, you're going to see exactly the same profile out there. This is done by Moon, his dissertation. So material resources are in the home are how the number of books that the child has at home, the number of CDs, whether there is a CD player in the home, there is a video recorder in the home, and so on and so forth. It's a lot about material that we can use to interact with a child. And then clearly, what you're going to see is it's not too surprising, but the higher the parental background, the more likely you're going to find those items there. And again, kind of flat over time. Some change, but not so much change. This is more a measure of stock than a measure of flow. Okay. Another one is cognitive stimulation, which is, are you reading to your child? Are you telling stories to your child when the child is young? But when the child is older, it is about Are you engaging the child into, you know, extracurricular activities that help with cognitive development, so on and so forth? And again, what you're going to see is these differences across socioeconomic groups, especially among the group that has more than high school, okay? So, versus the others. Okay? If you look at emotional support, is how often you praise the child. If the child comes to tell a story, how what is it that you do? Now, it's a little bit misleading, just because the number of items for this particular component of the home actually tends to reduce over time. So this is why there is this downward trend. But again, what you see is this parallel profile between high SES families and low SES families. Okay, if you break this up according to income quartiles, you're going to see exactly the same thing, even in cognitive stimulation, which would not necessarily cost parents money, if that's for at least for some of these items. And if you actually break this up by according to whether this is an intact family, meaning that parents, both biological parents are still married, broken versus blended families, or never married single mom, you're going to see also some differences out there across, even across these groups, okay? So this is a lot of what goes on in the home. Let me talk to you a little bit about schools and teachers. This is a study that was done in Ecuador. Really interesting, because what they wanted to do is to measure who are good teachers and how much can good teachers actually get children to learn more. There's nothing specific about kindergarten except that it was easier for them to do the research design with kindergarten children. But it's an ongoing study. They'll keep doing exactly the same thing for many years. It's fascinating that they're going to be able to do this. But basically, it's a very simple question. Do kindergarten teachers matter? This should be matter, not mayor. So apologize for the bad typo there. So the most difficult thing is, when I was a student in Brazil, I remember that there was one year that a new principal came to the school. And this new principal decided to organize classrooms according to the initial letter of the last name. I was in seventh grade. It was a disaster because half of my classmates were assigned to a different class. I mean, half of my friends were assigned to a different class. Now, this mattered because every class had its own team. So we had our soccer team, we had our volleyball team, we had our basketball team. So yeah, I had friends I had played with for many, many years. And suddenly I had to play against them. So I felt like, oh, this is really horrible, right? And I think that all these students also felt the same way. I know that 2 weeks later, the new principal reverted the decision and reassigned students that had been the same class for many years to be in the same class again, just because it was so. And when you think about, when you go to a school and you see a classroom, every time that I go now, at least I see, how is it that these students here ended up in this particular classroom, okay? So is it that they put together all children that are well-behaved in one classroom? Is it that they divided the students that tend to disrupt the class into each one of the classes, or is it that they actually put all of the disruptive students in the same class? Okay, so it's really difficult. My mom was a teacher, and she was a very good teacher for very badly behaved students. So her prize in her school was to get assigned the worst behaved children. I could tell stories. So the principal understood, oh, she is great. Well, she's really great at dealing with really badly behaved children. So I'm going to send all the badly behaved children her way. So when you look at her, you know, her performance as a teacher, you got to be thinking, what if she actually were assigned the best behaved students in the class? Would she do better as a teacher? Would she do worse as a teacher? And it's really difficult to do to measure teacher effectiveness if children are not randomly assigned to teachers. Okay, so there's a huge controversy in the literature about how to measure what teacher fixed effects mean, precisely because people are worried about non-random assignment to teachers. Okay, now what they're going to do is they are going to randomly match students to teachers. The compliance rate was close to 99%, basically because they had these random checks into the schools almost every week. And if they saw that a child was not in the right class, they would tell the principal, please contact the Minister of Education for your country to explain why this student is actually not in the classroom that he or she is supposed to be. So, and the minute that the principals understood that they had to contact the Minister of Education, they actually preferred to move the class back, the child back to the class the child was supposed to be. And the other thing is, so you can get the teacher fixed effects now, because we're going to have this random assignment between students and teachers, at least within a school. But what is a teacher effect? What is a teacher fixed effect? Is it something that are good teachers born good teachers? Or are good teachers random set of people that are trained to be good teachers? From the point of view of policy, this matters tremendously. Because if good teachers are born good teachers, then the only policy that you do is get the bad teachers fired and replace them with good teachers. The only problem is, do we have enough good teachers in the population to serve all the kids that we need to serve? But if good teachers are trained to be good teachers, then the policy is not necessarily to fire the bad teachers. The policy is, let's try to train the bad teachers into becoming good teachers. Okay, so answering this question, understanding what the teacher fixed effect is super important to guide policy. Otherwise, you can't guide policy. Now, I'm not saying that this student is perfect, because it's really a great advance, but in most situations in life, I might be like my mom. She was a great teacher for students that were badly behaved. I don't know if she would be an even better teacher for students that are greatly behaved, but from the point of view of policy, it matters to understand what's the right matching is going to be. Given a set of students and the set of teachers that you have, how can you actually match teachers and students in a way to maximize output in a school? Okay, so this study is not going to be able to do that, precisely because by randomly matching students to teachers, we're not going to have any idea about what the matching function should be like. Okay, so, but it's super interesting that they were able to do this. Super important. So, the problem on trying to identify or trying to open up the black box that is the teacher fixed effect is that most data on teachers to this day are actually uncorrelated with the teacher fixed effect. Okay, so it doesn't really matter much whether you actually throw in those variables into the regressions or not, just because they don't seem to matter much. Okay, so teacher certification, number of years of experience, except for maybe whether it's a rookie teacher or not a rookie teacher, and socioeconomic background of the teacher, almost nothing of those variables actually matter for predicting the teacher fixed effect. What these guys are going to do is they're going to measure personality by looking at the big five. They're going to measure IQ, the teacher's IQ. They're going to measure something else, which is this classroom observation tool. It's called the class. It's really about three things. Instructional support, number one. So how what is the quality of the interaction between teachers and students when the teacher is actually explaining something to the students? Okay, classroom organization. I think that this is the reason why my mom was so good as teaching badly behaved students, is because she was very good at behavior management, although she failed tremendously with me. Emotional support is I remember that there was a teacher when I was in eighth grade that there was no emotional support whatsoever. You got a question wrong, you started crying because your parents were going to beat you up, and they said, oh, clearly they didn't beat you up enough the last time, right? So no emotional support at all. It's like to this day when I see this guy, I start shaking and I have very, very, very mixed feelings about this. Okay, so if you will, I'm going to share this with you if you want to see a little bit more about the details. It was developed by people at the University of Virginia. Pianta is one of the leading researchers associated with this classroom. It's a measurement. It really is interesting because the way you do this is, it's like they're doing here right now, that they're taping it, right? So they tape it for a number of hours. It's usually the case that they don't look at the what's going on in the first hour, because most of what's going on in the first hour is people looking back at the camera, right? So observation actually affects behavior. Actually, it should affect my behavior. It's not, but then what they do is they actually get trained raters to rate 20-minute segments of this video independently. And they're basically scoring what's going on in the classroom in these three different metrics. And then you take averages across all of the raters. Now, hopefully, the raters agree on what's going on. And it's usually the case that they are trained. So the rating correlation is above 90%. But there is still another form of measurement error here, which is, you know, you come on a given day. What's going on in a given day is actually affected by outside forces. So, for example, if there is, you know, like in Brazil, right? So we love soccer. So if, you know, if I were to do this measurement right after the day Brazil lost 7-1 to Germany, would be a very different thing than the day that Brazil won the World Cup in 2002. Which was the last time we ever won the World Cup. We will never win again. But those things greatly will affect, because children are going to be either super excited or super depressed, and then a good teacher would try to actually do, you know, either control behavior when they're super excited, in which case we would oversample behavior management type of activities, or, you know, right after 7-1, it was a lot about emotional support, so we would see a lot of emotional support, kind of, right? So not so much instructional support that day, I imagine, but a lot of emotional support. Okay, so you still have this. It's an imperfect measure because it's contaminated with outside forces. Okay, so how is it they're going to do? So they're going to do this in two ways. So they're going to go in the first year, and then they're just going to do the class, randomly assign children to teachers, then measure how much children are learning so they can actually compute the teacher fixed effect, but also to compute the class. Then they're going to go back and do the same thing with the same with a different cohort of kindergarten students. And the idea is, I'm going to get rid of measurement error by instrumenting the class in the first year with the class in the second year. I'm going to instrument the class in the second year with the class in the first year. Okay, so that's the story that they're going to do. So in terms of teacher quality, what's really interesting is one standard deviation in the teacher fixed effect leads to 11% of a standard deviation a higher performance in math, 13% of a standard deviation higher performance in language, 7% of a standard deviation in executive function, which is how well children actually control their emotions, how well they actually behave in class, and so on and so forth. Okay, so same. What's really interesting is, it's not that you had some teachers that were good at teaching language and some teachers that were good at teaching math. So the same teachers that were good at teaching language, they were also likely to be good at teaching math. And the same teachers that were good to teach language in first year were also good to teach language in the second year, and so on and so forth. So some correlation, not very small as I would expect it to be, so which is super interesting. So now they have this teacher fixed effects. They're going to see, okay, so what is predicting the teacher fixed effect, right? So IQ, you move one standard deviation in IQ, which is huge change. You know how much you change in teacher fixed effect? 4% of a standard deviation. Very little. So it's not about IQ. So it's not getting the teachers to be smarter. Okay? Is it the one thing that moves them a lot is the first time that they're teaching, they're not very good at teaching. I actually had this experience myself. The first time that I, right after graduate school, it's so interesting. I spent so much time preparing my class, and I was so horrible delivering it. Not that I'm great now, but I was much worse then. So I actually felt that. It's super difficult. Not too surprised with the result, but it's large. Children that are randomly assigned to a rookie teacher, they learn 16% less if you combine all these scores in math, language, executive function, so on and so forth. So this is something that surprised people, because it doesn't really matter whether you look at each one of the big five components separately or you look at them in conjunction. No correlation between teacher fixed effect and teacher personality. It's not that openness to experienced teachers were more likely to be good teachers, or more conscientious teachers were likely to be good teachers. Nothing like that. You have a question?
Yeah. So
see, but the, so he, I okay. So remember when I was telling you about when I was in the job market, right? So the other one that I did was a big five personality test. I thought, oh my God, there we go. Okay. So the first question is, literally, are you a reliable person?
Yes.
Well, then I asked about this. I thought about this question. So if I answer yes and it's true, okay. But if I answer yes and it's not true, but what if I say no and I lie, right? So I would say what's really interesting about social-emotional skills and their measurement is that the bias should be towards not predicting any outcomes that we actually value. What's really interesting is that they do predict. So this is the big five. What's so fascinating about the big, what really scared me was the fact that almost every single large company used the version of the big five to determine who they were going to hire or not. And as I was going through this test, and I was thinking, these people are insane. But if you look at the literature, even if you measure big five early on and you follow these people later on, there is predictive value, in spite of the fact that by construction it should not, right? Because people could lie, right? So this is, I think that this is not an so if you think that this is okay, then you have to tell me, why is it that the prediction in other dimensions of life that people have documented happens but not here? What is the kind of lying that happens that doesn't predict how well teachers are going to be, but it predicts in the larger population how well they're going to be? Yeah. But why would they have a different, why do they have an incentive? Because they're not being paid according to their performance in the teacher fixed effects.
But this is like somebody is observing you, uh-huh. Affects your behavior.
It could affect my behavior, true. it could affect the measurement of the teacher fixed effect, but it would not necessarily affect, but it has to affect every day so that children will learn more. It cannot affect only on the day that they're measuring the camera, unless the day that they actually came to measure was a very important day for child development, right? And then it was on that day that they needed to teach well, right? You see where I'm going? So I'm going to go back to the issue of measurement. I understand what you're worried about. A lot of people are worried about exactly the same thing, that it's self-reported. We don't know, it not even be lying, right? It's my opinion about who I am, right? I might wake up at 3 p.m. every day, right? Not work hard at all, but I might say, I'm a really conscious person. That's the view that I have about myself. So people can be deluded. Right, so yeah, go ahead.
Well, there's no paradox, I think, in thinking that with respect to, say, the five result. There's no paradox saying that if you pick the person from the general population,
uh-huh,
and put them in a classroom, that their big five score would have a big effect.
But their big five score conditional on their having gone through a selection process to be a teacher.
Yeah.
We had more impact.
Yes, but if you look at the distribution of the big five among the people who were actually teachers, and you compare them to the overall population, it's not that different. Okay, so...
Right, but we don't want to get into the model here, but there could be something
it
that
could
is
be.
Correlated with the big five that is not actually being measured by the big five.
It could be. But I think that the larger point here is how we actually measure these skills, right? So if we were to measure socio-emotional skills in a different way, perhaps we would capture things that the big five are not currently capturing. That might be true. This is ongoing research. I don't think that this is actually ready to be tried out at a larger population. I know that Valerie is looking at me like you're... Oh, no, we can go on until like 3 p.m. That's a good point, Chris. No, let me just let me just finish one more slide, and then we'll finish this part of the presentation. But really, what's really interesting is what they recorded by the class. This measurement predicted 60% of the teacher fixed effect, which is not all of it, but it's super interesting that you actually have some notion now of what goes on into the classroom. That explains the teacher fixed effect. Some of it maybe you can train. Now Pianta, the reason why they developed the class is precisely because they wanted to see if we get teachers to perform better in a class scale, will it translate into more learning? And this is where the research is right now. Yeah, go ahead.
Do they look at whether one particular component of the class scores? If you have these three components, for example,
so this was what was interesting is that there was no one component that did better. The other interesting thing was it was not that the guys that did better, it's not that the class prediction varied according to the composition of the class. Is it a class mostly of low income children or high income children? Is it a class mostly of boys or girls? No. I mean, this is what was so interesting, is that it was not only one component, which makes it a little bit harder for policy, because it means that it's not that you need to teach them only how to manage class well. You need to teach them how to manage class well, but you also need them to teach how to provide emotional support when children are not failing and not progressing. And you also need to teach them how to actually deliver the class as well. So instructional support also matters tremendously. So these three things are super important. But really, two more things. So parents do know who the good teachers are. So you ask parents, before the class started, please rate this teacher. And the parents actually knew who would be scoring higher on either the fixed teacher fixed effect or the class. But the parents didn't actually change the behavior inside the home. So it's not that they, my child actually got this very difficult teacher this year, very demanding teacher. She's teaching my child a lot. I need to actually spend more time with homework. It's not that this is, which I know is not true for the PhD class. So what's really sad is this is what goes on in the US. So we do know that, and this is the slide before we actually break. So this is, exactly. So only 75 more slides and then we'll take like a 75 second break. So this is what's going on in the US. So this is a study that was done by the Ohio Department of Education. What they did was, let's look at teacher fixed effect in a given year. And then let's look at the students that are assigned effective teachers, okay? And the students that are assigned ineffective teachers, okay? So this is, here is, students, so these guys are the rich students, these guys are the poor students in this metric, because what really goes on here when you see like 90, this means that 90% of the children are actually eligible for free lunch, okay, or free or reduced price lunch. Okay, so the high SES children, most of them actually get an effective teacher, meaning a teacher whose score in the distribution of fixed effect teacher fixed effect is above the median. And then these are the guys that are the poor children actually get teachers that are mostly of them below the distribution of teacher fixed effect. Again, this is not a randomized control trial. You have to take this with a grain of salt because there might be something else going on. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
So I don't want to say that this is, I want to say that really the point here is that what I showed you in this first time, this first part of the class is that inequality has been increasing. We believe that inequality has been increasing at least partially because of the fact that the supply of skills in the United States is starting to grow at a lower rate, right? And then I showed to you that what's going on within, across socioeconomic groups in the United States in terms of the investments in human capital at home and also in the schools. So children who come from disadvantaged households, they tend to receive lower investments from basically the time that they are born until they graduate from high school, if they graduate from high school. And that happens because of the investments that happen in the home. It also happens in the investments that actually they receive through schools, okay? I'm going to stop here. We're going to continue with some little bit of theory, a little bit of econometrics in the next part of the class, okay? So yeah, quality of schools, quality of teachers really affect child development, right? There is inequality of assignment of teachers to students. But it's also the case that the more years you spend in school, the more you acquire in terms of child in terms of skills. So this is a study done by Sergio Sua, Joy Stixrud, and Jim Heckman. And the idea here is really trying to look at what is the impact of one extra year of schooling on cognitive and non-cognitive development. And as you can see, the more years you are in school, the more you are going to acquire, not too surprising, not only in terms of cognitive, but also socio-emotional skills, okay? So you would be worried that a lot of the things that I'm telling you is just correlational stories, but they are actually not only correlational stories, right? Because when you have randomized controlled trials, you actually, randomized controlled trials show that if you actually improve or increase investments in children, you will increase human capital formation. So Jim Heckman has been talking so much about Perry preschool programs, Abecedarian, other people have been going back to the Head Start data. What's so interesting about the Head Start study is really depends on, you know, so people were randomly assigned to a Head Start that was participating in the study or not, but the control group might have gone to a Head Start, might have gone to a high quality child care program as well. It's important to take that into account. But early intervention does increase human capital formation. It has some long-term effects, but what's really fascinating about it is there is some fade-out results. So early gains in cognitive skills are not actually, do not persist over time. Yet you see some gains at later ages because we believe that what the early childhood programs are changing are not only the cognitive skills but many other dimensions of human capital as well, okay? If you change the quality of the schools, children are affected, children attend, then you affect human capital formation as well. One such example is Dobie and Fryer's analysis of the Harlem Children's Zone. Another one that is super interesting that also happened here in Chicago is investment in non-cognitive skills, right? So there are a lot of people that just believe that, you know, investment in non-cognitive skills are really easy to be done. Just, oh, try hard. Try hard. Just try hard. Try hard. Right? And really, no. Suppose that you give me a problem that has no solution. Do you want me to try until I die? It wouldn't be optimal, right? So there is a notion of trying to recognize what the environment is and trying to react to it, right? So a lot of the interesting interventions at adolescence with respect to non-cognitive skills are actually not so simple. What they're doing is cognitive behavioral therapy, which is really telling them, you're going to operate in very different circumstances. Sometimes you're going to be in circumstance that you have to react in one way. Sometimes you're going to be in circumstances that you have to behave in a completely different way. So it's important you recognize the setting in which you are before you actually react. So the reaction has to be appropriate to the setting and has to be appropriate to the action as well. So this is what Heller et al. Do is this analysis of a cognitive behavior therapy to adolescents who are in school. And what's going on here is if you live your life in a dangerous neighborhood, every time that someone approaches you to commit some act of violence against you, you're going to learn how to defend yourself pretty well from an early age, because you need to be able to defend yourself to operate in this environment. The problem is, if I now put you in a different setting and someone approaches you, and your entire life was when someone approached you, someone wanted to do some act of violence, then in a different setting, the first reaction you're going to have is, they're going to do the same thing for me, I have to react exactly the same way. Well, not necessarily. Now you are in a different setting, so it's important that you recognize which setting you are, and then you do this. So it's super interesting. So the first day of this intervention, this cognitive behavioral therapy intervention, they pair adolescents, and then they give one of the adolescents a basketball, and then they tell the other guy, get the basketball from him. No one ever, apparently, from what I was told, ever, every time that they actually started such intervention with a group of students, ever tried to get the ball by asking, please give me the ball. Ever was like, oh, I'm going to beat you up. And then they go and they start fighting, and the other guy obviously starts resisting because, you know, and then they go, they let it go for 15 minutes, and they ask, why didn't you just ask? I said, oh, why would he give me the ball? Well, let's try. Can you please give me the ball? Here you go. So again, it's cognitive behavior therapy has been around many, many years. There are a lot of people that debate whether it's actually scientifically, the scientific validity. There are some studies that seem to do this. A lot of it is about collecting data and reacting. So the typical cognitive behavior therapy would, you know, one very like a exaggerated typical case would be, you know, suppose that I am completely insane. I say, oh, people think that Donald Trump is great. Okay, and then my cognitive behavior therapist would say, why don't you go to, you know, like 57th in university, and you ask people, do you think Donald Trump is great or not? And then you're going to have a sense of whether people's opinions confirm your views or not. And there are many people that actually seem to be surprised that the views that they hold about the world don't seem to confirm. In which case, cognitive behavior therapy tries to tell them, before you actually act, collect information about the setting where you are, and then think of what the appropriate response, instead of working according to the prior that you have about the setting. Okay, it's not cheap intervention, but the alternative is far more expensive, because crying actually costs a lot of money. Okay, so it's one of the most expensive things, actually, jails. Okay, so cognitive behavior therapy at these ages when children are developing, remember, it's about what's going on in the reward system versus what's going on in here. So might actually be super interesting. Before I go on to theory, let me show something else, which is, I told you about how differences in skills and differences in investments across socioeconomic groups for a given cohort. And unfortunately, what we are seeing is that over time, those differences actually have increased across cohorts. Okay, so Sean Raradon did this very interesting study in which he did the best that he could in order to make tests that were available at different stages of the life cycle, different years, comparable over time. What you see here are cohort birth, and then this is the standardized tests over time. the solid group, the solid lines, the blue solid line is the income gap in NEF. The solid red is the income gap in test scores in reading. As you can see, over time, the income gap, high income children perform relative to low income children perform, actually has been increasing over time, even though the the black-white gap has actually somehow decreased over time. So the income gap nowadays is larger than the black-white gap. Okay, so that's quite surprising. Why that's going on? Well, a lot of it is because differences in investment across socioeconomic groups are also increasing over time. So if you look at this study by Remy, until 1995, there were some differences between college and less college-educated and less-educated parents on how much time they spent with children. This is a time diary that is devoted to the parents, not so much to the children. So it captures differences across parents, but it doesn't capture all the differences across children, because children might be receiving some form of attention or investments from other people in the household. Okay. And from 1995, what you see is this increase in the gap in investments, at least as measured in time. Most of the difference is actually between age 0 to 5. Okay, so most of the gap that you see are for high SES, between high SES and low SES children, or in terms of time investment, is investment that happens before children are age 5. And if you look at expenditures on goods that promote child development, then what you see is this really large increase in inequality between low and high income groups in the distribution of in terms of how much they actually invest in children. So between 1983 and 2005, in these 20 years, there's almost no growth here. There was about close to 60% growth in investments for the high income group in terms of the investment. So the profiles that we've seen that worry us about investments, that worry us about child development, they actually are going to be even more problematic in the next years, because human capital is the inequality in human capital is increasing, inequality in investments is also increasing. Okay. So let me show to you a little bit of theory. Very little, not much. So the idea here is try to organize all of these data that we just seen into two concepts. One concept is the concept of self-productivity of skills. And the idea here is a very simple idea. Learning, if I learn one skill, that might actually help me acquire other skills. So, if I learn how to read, reading gives me access to books, which allows me to read about history, geography, mathematics, so on and so forth. I can even read about persistence, motivation, grit. I can read about everything. I can also read about bad things as well. But it's this idea that the first skills that you create are so important because they give you the necessary human capital to acquire more skills. Okay. And the other notion is the notion of the dynamic complementarity. It's the notion that if really human capital is a combination of many different types of skills, so it's not only the summation, because there might be interaction across these different types of skills. So human capital is not only knowing how to read plus knowing how to do math, but if I know how to read and I know how to do math, I might actually combine these two things. There's synergy among these two types of skills that make my human capital even more productive. So that's the notion of dynamic complementarity. And this is going to be super important for the way we think about how to, these two parameters are going to be super important about how to set up an optimal profile of investment over the life cycle, okay? So I'm going to show here the simplest problem that I can show. If you you can make this far more complicated, you can really treat this as a dynamic problem. You can add a lot of constraints to the parents, income constraints, budget constraints, intertemporal budget constraints in that matter. I'm going to step away from all of this in today's talk. But the idea here is, if I want to look at the optimal profile, one way that I can do this is trying to find what is the minimal cost of investment, right? And I'm going to have XE is going to be investment early on, XL is going to be investment later on. This is going to be XL is going to be multiplied by 1 over 1 plus R, which is the present value of the cost of the investment in the future. The idea here is I have $10. I can divide between early and late investment. I don't put the remaining of the $10 that I don't invest early, I don't put under my mattress. I actually take it to the bank and I earn some interest associated with it. And then human capital follows a production function. Gamma is going to be the self-productivity parameter that I told you. So if gamma is equal to 1, then all human capital is what you do early on. If you teach children how to read, then everything else the child can learn by himself or herself. They don't need anything else, regardless of the complementarity parameter. Okay. Now, so the gamma is going to be the self-productivity parameter. Phi is going to be this dynamic complement. This is self-productivity. This is going to be dynamic complementarity. Okay. So this is going to be the synergy between early and late investment in the production of different of human capital. Okay, so let's solve this problem for different cases of phi. The problem is for different cases of phi, I'm going to have what's called boundary solutions. I'm not going to have interior solutions. Okay, so if I have phi equal to 1. Then I can easily substitute between early and late investment. Okay? In which case, I have basically two investment strategies that I can consider. One is I put all the money that I have in early investment, and for every dollar that I put in early investment, I produce gamma units of human capital. That's going to be one investment strategy. Another investment strategy is I put all the money that I have into late investment. But first, I save it, put it in the bank. Then I get 1 plus R when the future arrives. And then I put 1 plus R times the amount of money that I have. For every dollar that I have, I'm going to produce 1 plus R times 1 minus gamma units of human capital. Okay? And I want to invest early, if and only if this inequality arises, which means that the higher the interest rate is going to be, the higher the gamma has to be for me to invest early. Right? So that would be one solution to the problem if phi is equal to 1. Now, if phi goes to minus infinity, then I end up with what is known as the Leontief production function, in which case it's going to be human capital. This is like the most amount of in this one case here, I call it the dark cave case. The dark cave case is the following: the child, if I want to invest early, I drew all the investment early on, and then I put the child in the cave. And then once the child is actually adult, I take the child, send the child to the labor market. The other possibility is I want to invest late. I first put the child in the dark cave, and when it's time for the child to go to college, I send the child to, you know, great college, take the child out of the dark cave, and that's it. Now, this is the opposite case, which is if I, at any point, I don't invest, then human capital is going to be 0. So here's the situation in which the best that I can do is to invest early and invest late exactly the same amount. Okay, so this is going to be whatever value of R, because the human capital is going to be the minimum level of investment that I have. So if I invest too much late, not so much early on, and just spent resources, just wasted resources investing late, and the opposite is also going to be true. For any other value of phi, what I'm going to have is a closed form solution, which means that I'm going to have the following ratio, that the ratio between early and late investment is going to depend, yes, again, on the interest rate. The higher the interest rate, the lower the ratio between early and late. And the higher the self-productivity parameter,
the higher the ratio is going to be for early investment. So these are, and you can see this by this picture that tells you, so assuming that R is equal to zero, and for different values of gamma, for different values of phi, what is the optimal ratio between early and late investment? And as you can see, it really depends on what gamma is going to be. It really depends on what phi is going to be. So as phi goes to minus infinity, the ratio is one. As phi becomes a larger and larger value, how much you're going to devote to early versus late depends on gamma. And as phi becomes a larger and larger value, more sensitive to the interest rate, the optimal investment profile is going to be. Okay? So this is theory. We need to find a way to determine what gamma and phi is going to be. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. Okay, so let me emphasize the dual side of dynamic complementarity. Because dynamic complementarity is really saying that the return to late investment, so who are the children we're going to send to the best colleges? Well, the children we're going to should send to the best colleges are the children that actually have higher levels of human capital by the time that they go to college. Okay. So that's saying that early and late, so the return to late investments really depend on the return on what happened with early investments. But the opposite is also true. So you don't want to invest early a lot if you're not going to invest late a lot as well. So this is one of the sad things that happened with the Perry-Preschool program. We know that that had a positive impact, but I always ask myself, what would have been the impact of the Perry-Preschool program if children also received higher quality schools after they actually finished their participation in the Perry-Preschool program? What would have happened with the return to the Perry-Preschool program if they actually had continued to invest a lot more on those children after they actually participated in the program? So, unfortunately, we don't know about all of this. So the literature, so be careful when you see people saying early investment is important. It doesn't mean that it's sufficient. Okay, no one is saying that it's sufficient. It's just saying that if we want to produce human capital, lots of human capital, the cheapest way to do so is to start producing a lot of human capital early on and then continue at later stages of the life cycle. But it's not, you know, it's not that people are saying, oh, it doesn't really matter what comes later. No, no one is saying that. Okay, so here's, so we need, in order to find out what should be the ratio of early to late investments, because this is just a theoretical construct, theory doesn't tell us anything without data, we should actually try to estimate this. So this is going to be a little bit more complicated because the econometrics are a little bit more difficult once you look at the data we're going to look at. So I'm going to have this notation here that is going to be accompanying us for like the next half an hour, or a little, maybe a little bit more than that. So this is going to be, thetas are going to be skills, x is going to be investment, okay? And etas, I want you to think of etas as either shocks that are not controlled by parents, but they are known by parents, or observed by parents, but not by the econometricians, or they are unmeasurable inputs that the parents actually choose. For what I'm going to do today, it's not going to be too much of a difference whether it's this case or this case, okay? But theta C is going to be cognitive skill, theta N is going to be non-cognitive skill, T is going to be the child's age, and then X is going to be the investment in the child skill, K, okay? So I'm going to do this horrible formulation of the problem, that child development at age T plus one is a very specific function of what happened before, these stocks of skills before, the investment, parental skills, and then these shocks that I, sorry, this should be little k, not c, little k. In the, these shocks are unmeasurable inputs. Now, this might look like very different from what I wrote here, but you can actually transform the problem from this formulation here to this more complete formulation here. Okay, so if you can read a paper that Heckman and I have on this topic. Happy to tell people where you can find that paper to see how we arrive at this more complete formulation here. Okay, so the data are going to be the SYNLSY data. just the firstborn white children. There is an issue of measurement, comparability of measurement of skills, especially non-cognitive skills across races in the CNLSY. They believe that parental reports are not comparable across different races. So we focus on white children. I recently redid the exercise looking at different populations. It's true that the reporting for non-cognitive skills are not different, are somewhat different, but the production function parameters are not so different. Okay, so for different ethnic groups. Okay, racial and ethnic groups. So a lot of observations. You're going to see why. So 2,200 firstborn, but almost 400,000 observations. A lot of parameters, because we're going to assume that skills and investments are measured with a lot of measurement error. I want you to start from there. And then maybe you're going to be horrified with what I'm going to show to you in terms of measurement error. Okay. So what is good about the CNLSY dataset is that they have really extensive data collection on a number of things. And the data collection happens every 2 years. so I'm going to divide what you see here is going to be like 8 different periods of child development, 0, 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so on and so forth. Okay. So child's cognitive skills are measured primarily at early ages on the from this motor social development scale. If you look at the items of the motor social development scale, it's very similar to standardized items from Bailey scale of infant development, which trained psychologists use. This one depends on maternal reports, which by itself is problematic because a child may have skills, but the mother may never observe these skills because the mother is not trying to get the child to do those types of skills at home. And in a laboratory setting, the psychologist will induce the child to reveal those skills by engaging tasks with the child. Okay, parts of body is and memory for locations. They had this early test, turned out to be very difficult to do in the field. Parts of body is the ask the child, they say the word, you know, like arm, and then they wait to see if the child is going to look at the arm. Then some children did this, and then the research assistant had to, you know, make the assessment. Yeah, the child looked at the arm, or maybe the child did not look at the arm. And research assistants really complained a lot about the difficulty of doing this. The memory for location is really cute. What it is like you have like a Mickey Mouse picture, and then you have like 3 cups, and then you play around, and then you ask the child, under which cup is the Mickey Mouse picture, and then children, right? And then you add a 4th cup, and then you add a 5th cup, and children start gambling. Oh, it's gonna be great. Took a long time to do those tests, so they ended up getting rid of that test as well. So they did for a couple of years, but it was super difficult. The data I showed to you was primarily based on the PIAT and the PPVT. The PPVT is this picture vocabulary. I'm going to show you a typical picture vocabulary question in like 20 minutes or so. PIAT is literally a school test. It's like basic math, basic reading, and so on and so forth. Non-cognitive skills is this temperament and behavior problem index. This is reported by the parents. This is the antisocial scale that I showed to you before. It's one of the components. The parental investment is the component of this home score we discussed. Parental cognitive skills is we actually showed you what these tests. This is the ASVAB test to measure cognitive skills, and then the self-esteem and locus of control to measure non-cognitive skills. Okay, so a lot of tests, but the problem is none of them are actually direct observations of the constructs of interest. They are measurement of the things we want to do, but we don't have the slightest idea how well they measure things. the one problem is we don't know. Test scores are really something fascinating. If you look at the way people work with test scores, they always transform this so that there is a mean zero variance one, and then they tell you some distance from the mean in terms of how many standard deviations from the mean you are. Well, if you really want to look at estimate a production function like this, now you have to attach some real meaning to human capital. So you can't actually say you're 3 standard deviation from the mean. 3 standard deviation from what mean? What does it mean? So you need to transform test scores into some real metric. Some, how does it mean in terms, what does it mean, what is human capital in terms of earnings, in terms of probability of graduation from high school, and so on and so forth. So everything we're going to do to estimate the production function will be in terms transforming these test scores in terms of some predictive value of something we know has a natural metric. So if someone makes $2,000 a year, and someone, sorry, $2,000 a week, and someone else makes $1,000 a week, I can say that the guy that makes $2,000 a week makes twice as much money than the guy that makes $1,000 a week, right? I can say that. If I say that you are, 1.5 standard deviations above the mean, and I am 0.75 standard deviations above the mean, I can't say that you have twice as much human capital that I do. I can't. There is no natural meaning associated with that. So these are the three problems. So we don't observe the things that we want to observe directly. Even if the test scores were perfect measures of human capital, they have no metric. So we need to be able to transform them in a metric that has meaning. And then a lot of people would be worried about the fact that investments are endogenous. They react to things that we observe about children, but also things we don't observe about children. Okay, so and especially we're worried about how they relate to ADA K parameters. Okay, so this is going to be the difficulty. When I was presenting this paper to maximize, to make me really look smart, I would say it's such an easy problem. Here's what we're gonna do. So we're gonna estimate this function here. I don't observe the left hand side and I don't observe the right hand side. Even if I did, I wouldn't care about those because they don't have the right metric. And even if I did and they had the right metric, I would still have the endogeneity problem. So super easy problem to solve. You just sit in the office for 6 years to do that. So here's what's going to happen. Let me give you a sense of, I want to say that the most important problem in this literature is measurement error. Okay, so people worry about endogeneity. They should worry about endogeneity. But really, really, what's really the issue here is how bad we measure skills and investments in children. And if you don't confront that, it's going to be like you lost the battle from the beginning. The problem is that confronting that is really super difficult in terms of econometrics. Okay, so I'm going to, the next 20 minutes will be painful, but hopefully it will be like a great learning experience for you, because I think that this is where you're going to see a lot of research being done nowadays, trying to make all of the algorithms much simpler than what I'm going to present to you. But I want you to give a sense, to have a sense of how you can actually account for measurement error if you're actually interested in doing research on human capital formation. Okay, So let me start with this production function. Let me start with the simplest production function that I could, which is I just want to see if human capital tomorrow responds to investments today. That's all that I want to see. I would like to see, is beta different from zero, beta equal to zero? And let's assume away the fact that we don't have measures of, we don't have the metric for human capital. Let's assume away the issue of endogeneity of X. Let's just assume that X is randomly assigned across people, okay? And then if this were the case, then what I would do is a simple OLS regression in which I would look at the covariance between human capital tomorrow and investments today divided by the variance of investment today. That's all that I would do. I would get beta. If we observe theta, if you observe X, no measurement error, no endogeneity problem, and I knew the scale that of human capital. Here's the problem. The data that we have is not theta and X. The data that we have are measures of, this is going to be super confusing. This should be Y1, Y2, Y3, and Y4. Okay, so I apologize for that. There is going to be some gain associated with starting from this guy being called Y1, the other guy being called Y2. So I apologize for that. I'll fix this before I make this available to you guys. So what we have is, we have something that we believe is measuring investments in children, but there is a measurement error. So you have at least two of such measures. And then we have some tests that we believe measure one particular form of skills, one particular form of human capital, but also has measurement error associated with it. Okay. So far, what I'm going to assume is that this measurement error is classical. So they are uncorrelated with theta, they are uncorrelated with x, they're uncorrelated with each other. You can relax that, but you still need some uncorrelation assumption to be able to make progress on this thing. But if you have some of these covariance restrictions that I told you, although you don't observe this guy here directly, you can actually compute exactly what this term is going to be by looking at this ratio of covariances here. Okay? So you can replace this guy with this guy, and this is and the key to be able to do this is that at least some of these measurement errors, these epsilons, are uncorrelated with each other. Okay? So you have at least some guys that are uncorrelated. Okay? But and it's possible to relax this if you actually have more measures. I'm not going to go much into it. It's also possible to relax this if you say, maybe some of the measures are actually not linear functions of this guy. Maybe they are nonlinear functions of this guy. It's also going to work well. Some of the items, for example, are dichotomous, 0-1 random variables, in which case they wouldn't be linear functions of the things that you want to measure. So that's a useful result as well. Okay. So I can't do this type of. So in principle, I could do this method of moments type of estimation. The reason why I can't is because the CNLSY not always, so they follow people every 2 years, but sometimes they don't follow everyone. Sometimes people move, they can't find people. So missing data is going to be a serious issue in the CNLSY. So they may not be, so if you're following people for 16 years, the probability you're not going to see them in at least in one of the rounds is going to be pretty high in the CNLSY, as it is in almost every single longitudinal study that there is out there. So you need to find a way. You don't want to drop people that are not in the CNLSY at least in one of the rounds. Otherwise, you're going to have like maybe 150 observations. Okay, you're going to have a super selected sample of people who are always participating in the CNLSY no matter what. So you need to come up with a estimation algorithm that addresses measurement error, but also is sensitive to the issue of missing data. Okay, so the way the literature in engineering and in economics has approached this problem is by looking at something that is known as the filtering types of algorithms. It's super simple. Don't let the math misguide you. Okay? So now this is where Chris tells me that my presentation don't necessarily follow the slides. Absolutely true. So here's what I want you to keep in mind. So I'm going to have this very simple example. I made a change to the production function. Now it's squared. I want you to see how to handle nonlinearity. Linearity is going to be very simple. Nonlinearity a little bit more problematic. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write the likelihood function of the data that I observe is y1, y2, y3, and y4. Right? So these are the four data points for each person in my data set. Then I'm going to break this up in the following way. I'm going to say this is the likelihood of y1 times the likelihood of y2 conditional on y1 times the likelihood of y3 conditional on y1 and y2, then the likelihood of y4 conditional on y1, y2, and y3. So I'm going to the first step is to derive this guy here. That's going to be step one in my presentation now. This is going to be step two. Oh, sorry. And then this is going to be step three. Now I'm not going to show step four, which would be this guy here, but you're going to see that once I tell you how to do this one guy here, this would be exactly the same thing. So it would be to go back to actually step one. Okay? So this is what I'm going to show to you. It's super useful. People are working on refining this algorithm to make it more simpler to estimate. they're working on it, so they actually develop versions for R, for Stata, and so on and so forth. So I think it's quite interesting to do that. Now, there is a reason why I want to do break up in this way, is because this is a highly dimensional computational problem. As the number of periods increase, the computational time to compute this guy here is going to be really, really big. But this guy here, this guy, and this guy, you can compute very fast. So breaking up the problem from this way to this way, you actually go much faster. Okay, so this is why I want to show this to you. Okay, so let me start, let me make the assumption that X is a normal. This is going to be the work that I did with Heckman and Shenak. We assume that it's a mixture of normals. We should say that the distribution function of the variable X is a convex combination of the distributions of many different normal distribution functions. So it's a little bit less restrictive. I could do everything that I'm going to do with mixture of normals. It's just that I would have to accumulate more and more terms, do those steps more and more times. It would get no insight, extra insight from it. It would just add to the amount of computation that I would have to do with you guys. But if I actually have X as a normal random variable, and I told you that Y1 is equal to mu1 plus X plus epsilon 1, and I told you that X is normal with mean 0 variance sigma 2 sigma 2 X, and epsilon conditional on X is normal mean 0 sigma 2 1, then I don't have endogeneity problem, because I'm already assuming the distribution of epsilon condition on X is the same regardless of the value of X. So for now, so far, I'm just trying to attack the measurement error problem. I'm assuming away the endogeneity problem. I'm going to come back to the endogeneity problem in a second. But if I have that, then so these two assumptions, they imply that Y1 is also normal with mean mu1 plus, mean mu x. Mu x and variance sigma 2 x plus sigma 2 1. And what you're going to see, this guy here, this contribution of the likelihood, is exactly going to be the density of a normal random variable. This is what I wrote here. One issue that is going to arise here is I'll be able to separately identify sigma 2 x from sigma 2 1 because look at what's going on here, just a second. The epsilons are independent from each other. So when I look, when I take the covariance between y1 and y2, the covariance between y1 and y2 is going to be equal to the variance of x, which is sigma 2x, sigma square x. So I'm going to be able to identify that guy. But from here, it's clear that I can't separately identify mu1 from mu x, because these are two intercept terms. I either have to normalize this guy to zero, or I have to normalize this guy to zero. One of the two. Okay. So, but that other than this normalization, this is going to be the first term. Okay. So step one, super simple, right? Step one, super simple. Step two is a little bit more complicated. Step two, I need to now derive what is the distribution of y2 condition on y1. So to do that, I'm going to first derive the distribution of x condition on y1. Okay? This is what you're going to see here. Now, the normality assumption is super useful because it tells me that the expected value of x condition on y1 is the expected value of x plus the covariance between x and y1 divided by the variance of y1 multiplied by y1 minus the expected value of y1. So this is a formula that you can check. Wikipedia has it. Every place you Google it has it. If I replace each one of these terms now, I'm going to pick up that the expected value of x given y1 is this guy, and the variance of x given y1 is this formula here, which is the value of x, the unconditional variance of x, minus the square of the covariance between x and y1 divided by the variance of y1. You replace these terms, you're going to have that the variance of x given y1 is sigma square x minus sigma 4x divided by sigma squared x plus sigma squared 1. Okay? So this is what's going on here. Well, x is normally distributed, epsilon is normally distributed, which means that y is normally distributed, which means that y and x are jointly normally distributed. What I just derived is the conditional moments of two normally distributed random variables. So I drew that. Why does it help me? Helps me because of this. Because now, well, helps me because I have that y2 is mu2 plus x plus epsilon 2. Then I say expected value of y2 condition y1 is, well, mu2, which is a parameter, plus expected value of x conditional on y1 plus expected value of epsilon 2, sorry, condition y1. I'm going to make the assumption that this is classical measurement here, which means that this guy is actually equal to 0. I've already I've already derived what this term is going to be. And then the variance of y2 condition on y1 is going to be equal to the variance of x condition on y1 plus the variance of epsilon 2 condition on y1. This guy here, I'm going to assume, is sigma squared 2. And this guy here, I've already derived. This is already what I did already in step 2. So I've already derived both of these terms, and I'm just going to replace the formulas in here that I derived, which means that the contribution of the likelihood of y2 condition on y1 is going to be exactly the formula that I have here. Okay? So just replace this guy here with that guy there, this guy here with this guy there, you're going to be fine. Okay? So done with this term. Then of this term. See, what's going on? This is all because of measurement error. I'm doing all these extra steps precisely because I don't want to trust that the data that I have doesn't have measurement error. Okay? So now the thing is going to become, now I drew exactly the same step. So I want to determine what the expected, what is the distribution of y3 condition on y1 and y2 is going to be. First, I'm going to do the following. I'm going to derive the distribution of x condition y1 and y2. I'm not going to do these steps again, but it's just the same formula that I applied before. You're going to see exactly the same formulas that I applied before. I'm just going to say, let's call the mean of x conditional on y1 and y2 is going to be this guy, and then the variance is going to be this guy here, right? Okay, so that I'm not going to do the algebra. It's a great exercise for you to do the algebra. Expect you to do the algebra before you meet with me, you know, ever. I remember you forever. The next time I see you, might be 30 years from now, I'm going to ask you, did you finish the derivation? It's going to be great conversation. Okay, so the problem is, if you go back here, is that y3 is not a function of x. y3 is a function of theta. What I have is the distribution of x condition on y1 and y2. Why is it useful to me? Well, it's useful to me because I know that theta is a function of x, right? So now I'm going to use this relationship between theta and x, which is the object of interest. What I really want is to estimate alpha and beta. I want to say if I change x, how much more human capital will I get, right? So now, I'm going to do the following. I'm going to now apply something. Look at this. The expectation of theta conditional on y1 and y2 is equal to alpha plus beta expectation of x squared conditional y1 and y2. I already know the entire distribution of x conditional on y1 and y2. In particular, I know the expected value of x squared conditional on y1 and y2 plus the expectation of the error term. Now, this eta here is really the issue of endogeneity. So y1 and y2 are measures of investment. If I believe the parents are reacting to ADA in order to determine what the investments are going to be, then I would expect that the expectation of ADA conditional on Y1 and Y2 is going to be equal to zero. But so far, I am avoiding the issue of endogeneity. I'm assuming that X, the investments are randomly assigned across parents, across families. So right now, my presentation assumes that this is actually equal to zero. I'm going to come back to relax this assumption in a second. Okay. So if this production function were linear in X, then this would be trivial to derive because I would have already derived expectation of X condition on Y1 and Y2. And I would also have the variance of X condition on Y1 and Y2. But it's not. It's actually quadratic in X. So this is going to be a little bit of a trouble. So when you see the paper with Heckman and Shenak, what you're going to see is that this is going to be, we're going to use something that is called the uncertain transform. What the uncertain transform is going to do is, how can I get that guy, the expectation of theta and the variance of theta, how can I approximate that expectation there? Because if I can approximate the expectation of theta condition on Y1 and Y2, the variance of theta condition on Y1 and Y2, the third moment of theta condition Y1 and Y2, and so on and so forth, I can then start making progress on this question. Okay, so here is the variance. So I need somehow to approximate at least the expectation and the variance of theta, condition Y1 and Y2. Okay, so I'm going to assume for now that not only that there is mean independence of eta, eta is exogenous, but also for simplicity, I'm going to assume that the variance of theta condition Y1 and Y2 is also constant. This one here is easier to relax. This one here is not so easy to relax. I'll talk more about relaxation of this thing in a second. Okay. Okay. So here's what I'm going to do. So the uncertain transform is very simple. The uncertain transform is just saying, let's just look at three points and give each one of these points a particular weight. So evaluate those random variables into point number one, which is going to be, sorry, this should be mu of x condition on y1 and y2 minus sigma of x condition on y1 and y2 times one, the square root of 1 plus kappa. I'm going to tell you what kappa is in a second. And then I'm going to give this this point here the following weight, 1 divided by 2 times 1 plus kappa. Point number 2, point number 3 is the polar opposite of this guy, so number 1. So instead of minus, it's going to be plus. But point number 2 is going to be mu of x condition on y1 and y2 with weight kappa, 1 plus kappa. Why do I want to do this? Well, it's super interesting because if you actually, and then I'm going to approximate, this is the, I would like to get expected value of theta condition on y1 and y2. What I'm going to do is I'm going to approximate that moment in the following way. It's going to be omega j times alpha plus beta, and this is going to be one of the point, the jth point of evaluation, one of the three points. And I'm going to approximate the variance of theta condition y1 and y2 with this formula here. I'm going to look at the value of that particular j point, the value of the expression at the particular j point. I'm going to subtract the mean that I computed in the first stage. Then I'm going to take the square. I'm going to take it to the square. I'm going to give this omega j weight. I'm going to sum across all the across all of these three points. I'm not going to forget about the sigma 2 eta, which is the variance of the eta term. Okay, so that's all that I'm going to do, super simple. And if you do that, what's nice about that is that you get these expressions here. Now, here's kappa. I still have to define what the value of kappa is going to be, right? So how do I pick kappa? For the particular problem that I chose, for this particular quadratic function that I chose, actually, I can show to you that there is closed-form solution for this. Guys, look at this. The closed-form solution for the expectation of theta condition on y1 and y2 is alpha plus beta times mu squared the square of the mean condition on y1 and y2 plus the variance condition of x condition on y1 and y2. Look at what the approximation gives me. You see what the approximation is giving me? Exactly the same value, right? Okay, so now look at the variance. The variance is beta square times 2 sigma, the square of the variance of the conditional variance of x plus 4 times the conditional mean squared of x times the variance, the conditional variance of x plus sigma 2 plus the variance of eta. So this is the exact formulation of the moment that I am interested in. This is the approximation that is going to give me. This term is exactly equal to that term. This term exactly equal to that term, right? This guy here exactly equal to that guy. The only term that I have free is kappa. Kappa should be equal to 2. For this moment here, the approximation of this moment should be exactly equal to that moment over there, right? Okay? So you say, oh, why is it useful? The reason why this is useful is because there is someone in the 1960s that showed that this function here, that you see here, which is known as constant elasticity of substitution function, can be approximated as a product, as a quadratic function of the logs of these terms, of the logs of the terms. Okay? So the reason why kappa equal to 2 is so useful is because I can approximate this function with a quadratic function. But if it is a quadratic function with normal mixture of normals, then I know that kappa equal to 2 will be exactly the right value for the approximation. So the approximation will be exactly equal to the objects that I want to approximate. Okay? So work through this. It's not too difficult. Work through this. Encourage you to take a look at this. But what I've just done is, if I now know what expectation of theta is going to be condition on y1 and y2, and the variance of theta condition on y1 and y2, then I know that what is the expectation of y3 condition on y1 and y2, and I know the variance of y3 condition on y1 and y2. If I know those two things, I know how to approximate this term now, which is the step number 3. Now, step number 4 is exactly like step number 1. First, you do what is the expectation of theta condition on y1, y2, and y3. What is the variance of theta condition on y1, y2, and y3. And once you know those guys, you will know, what's the expectation of y4 condition on y1, y2, and y3. What is the variance of y4 condition on y1, y2, and y3. Okay? So measurement error is really easy, but computationally complex. It's boring, but it's possible to address those things in a meaningful way. Problem number 2. Problem number 2 is the issue that a lot of people, Kevin Lang has been working on this issue a lot nowadays, which is I don't have, test score doesn't have a natural metric. What we're going to do is transform the data. So let's say that I have, for example, earnings of individuals when they are, 30 years old. And I have the test scores when they when they are 14 years old. So this tells me that this coefficient here is telling me one standard deviation in cognitive skills at age 14 is going to transform into log earnings according to this alpha C term. And one standard deviation in non-cognitive skills at age capital T is going to transform into log earnings according to this alpha N term. Okay? This means that I can think of this guy here as measured in terms of log earnings, cognitive skills measured in terms of log earnings, non-cognitive skills measured in terms of log earnings. So when I do the, when I now look at the stocks of skills, I'm going to keep track not on theta, but alpha k times theta, which is going to tell me this is scales in terms of earnings. So I'm going to have cognitive skills in terms of earnings later on here, I'm going to have cognitive skills in terms of earnings, cognitive skills in terms of earnings as well. Okay, so this is just literally looking at what is the predictive value of skills many years from now in the future and transforming the stocks of skills into those things today. Okay, that's easy. The third thing is also a little bit difficult because, sorry, oh gee. So basically what we're going to have between the addressed endogeneity is we're going to have the production function of human capital. We're going to have a policy function for investment. So investment is going to be a function not only on the terms that are inside the production function, but hopefully terms outside the production function. So for example, you can look at parental household earnings. Higher income households are going to invest more in children. You can look at innovations in household earnings as a way to look at innovations in investments in children, and then look at what the innovations in investment, because of innovations in earnings, how it will affect the accumulation of skills. So it's exactly, it's a non-linear version of instrumental variables. That's the way we're going to address endogeneity of skills. But I really think that in this literature, the number one problem to be addressed is going to be the measurement error in investments in skills. So let me show to you a little bit of what we find in this paper with Suzanne Shanak and James Heckman. So, so this is production function of cognitive skills. So this self-productivity parameter is super interesting. It goes early on, doesn't seem to be as important as it is at later stages. The value actually doubles from 0.4 to over 0.9. For cognitive skills, moving investments early on seem to be super important. So it's 0.3 early on, and then goes back to 0.02 at later stages. Okay, so that would indicate that cognitive skills are super sensitive to early investment, not so much to late investment. Elasticity of substitution, it's very interesting. this, what we find is the elasticity of substitution to be close to 4, meaning if children start life with not so much human capital, that turns out not to be so important. It's easy to remediate. But as time goes by, this elasticity of substitution actually starts to become larger and larger, which means that it's becoming more and more difficult to remediate when students actually get older. Okay. Now the other. So this is for cognitive skills. Now there is a similar production function for non-cognitive skills. And self-productivity is high at all ages, meaning once students acquire those skills, they're going to be able to actually keep learning more about those things by themselves. But the other thing that is super interesting is investments are not so different between early and late periods of the life cycle. And elasticity of substitution is actually at early stages not so high, as not as high as cognitive skills, but at later stages actually higher than cognitive skills, than the one for cognitive skills, which means that if it might, this result suggests that it's actually easier to remediate through late investment, it's easier to remediate with non-cognitive skills than cognitive skills. Okay, so that would be consistent with what a lot of the these new interventions on behavior cognitive behavior therapy that tries to remediate by affecting the amount of non-cognitive skills that people have. That would be totally consistent with this result. Focus on non-cognitive skills. Don't focus so much on cognitive skills. The rewards to cognitive to investing late at non-cognitive skills for disadvantaged youth will be higher than the returns to investing in cognitive skills. Now, a lot of people are working on expanding this analysis, looking at, you know, can we produce other estimators that are easier to implement computationally? Do we need as many? One thing that I didn't mention much is, you need a lot of covariance restrictions. We actually assume a lot of covariance restrictions. A lot of people are asking, do we actually need as many covariance restrictions as were imposed? Do we need all of the measures to be linear, or can we allow some of these measures to be nonlinear in practice? Watch out for a lot of people who are working on this. Kostas Megiro, Ratio Atanasio are working on it. Matt Wieswall is working on this, a lot of other people working on this. So we expect a lot of new results in this literature. Okay, so, but I started this saying, I had this picture, which was a theoretical picture. what is the optimal early to late ratio? And this is theory. We would like to see what's if we look at the data, what would the data tell us what the optimal is going to be? Now, here is where this is super interesting. Because the optimal depends on the outcome of interest. So if I actually want to target an outcome that is very sensitive to non-cognitive skills, what should I do? Huh? Should I invest more early, more late, more equally early and late? What should I do? Huh? More late, right? If I want to actually target outcomes that are super sensitive to cognitive skills, what should I do? I would invest more early, right? So this is what these numbers would suggest. And this is basically what we find. Remember, I really want to transform the measure of human capital in a natural metric. So if the natural metric, if the metric that I'm attaching, the outcome I'm measuring human capital, ultimately is going to be super sensitive to cognitive skills, then I'm going to want to invest a lot early, not so much late. On the other hand, if I want to target outcomes that are super sensitive with respect to non-cognitive skills, then I have an opportunity because non-cognitive skills, I can invest early, but I can also invest a lot late. The productivity is about the same. Yeah, go ahead.
What did you find for the parameter on the self-productivity?
Great. So for cognitive skills, early on, not so important. Later on, becomes more important. For non-cognitive skills, about the same, early and late. Okay, non-cognitive skills, it doesn't seem to be the case that they are too much difference between early and late. Actually, if you could, one could make the case, if the interest rate is very, very high, that you actually want to save a little bit early and then devote more resources later on. If you live in a country like Brazil, where the interest rate is like 40% a year. So not so clear in the US that you want to do that. So self-productivity increases over time for cognitive skills. Dynamic complementarity increases over time for cognitive skills. Self-productivity almost is stable for non-cognitive skills. Dynamic complementarity close to stable for non-cognitive skills as well. So here's the notion. So education is particularly sensitive to cognitive skills. So when I target education, I want early to be 50% higher than late. When I target crime, then I want early to be more close to late, only about 25% higher. But if I keep looking at particular components of crime that are super sensitive to non-cognitive skills, then I'm going to get those numbers closer and lower and lower, this ratio of optimal early to late investment, lower and lower. So it's not that early has to be always greater than late. It really depends on the type of outcomes that you are interested in. Some outcomes you really want to target more late investments. Other outcomes you want to target more early investment. Now, if I want people to be educated and I don't want them to become criminals, because intelligent criminals might be very difficult for us to fight. So I want them to be intelligent. I want them to have very high education attainment. I want them to not be likely to participate in crime. I want them to have healthy lives and so on and so forth. Probably what you're going to look like is a profile of investment that is going to be about the same across all stages of the life cycle. Because a linear combination of all of these guys will drive lower investment a little bit lower, higher investment a little bit higher, so later investment a little bit higher. So do not ever think that the theory we actually wrote implies it's only early investment. It's actually a profile of investment. Dynamic complementarity makes early investments important, but it also means that late investments have to be there as well. Okay, measurement error. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, that's a great question.
We didn't actually have, we couldn't say that when you're reading a book to a child. You know, when you read a book to a child, there's always like a non-cognitive message in there. You know, try hard, you know, go after your goals, don't get distracted along the way. So there's also the language component. Super hard to say a particular types of investments, whether they are actually only for cognitive and only for non-cognitive. Now, there are people that are trying to decompose each one of the components of investment. Are they more predictive of cognitive development or socio-emotional development? But I think that the results are still not there yet. What we do know is that you can target language development by engaging in certain type of language interaction with the children. We know that. But people that are looking at language development are not looking at, are these children also becoming better behaved? Are they increasing the stocks of socio-emotional skills? So we don't know even those simple questions from randomized controlled trials that are ongoing on. Okay, so measurement error. Okay, so measurement error is going to be really a huge problem. And here's why. Oh my God, I don't know what happened. So here's what's going on. Blue is, I can divide for each one of these components is how much is this true signal of the thing I want, either theta or x, how much of it is noise, has nothing to do with actually what I want, okay? So some of these guys are really good. Some of these guys, they have a signal to noise ratio. Blue is signal, yellow is noise. Signal to noise ratio of 95%. Very few of them have a signal-to-noise ratio below 40%. But they're doing fine for cognitive skills, but not perfectly fine. It's not perfect, not at all perfect. It should worry you that the typical ratio here is 60% and there's a lot of variability. And these are tests that people believe are the best tests to measure cognitive skills to this date, okay? As children get younger, then this thing becomes, socio-emotional development. Measurement error is even more problematic here. So the highest that you get in terms of signal to noise is 60%. Okay, so you should be worried about this. As student age becomes a little bit better, but not much. Here's investment. See how much yellow in investment? This is really problematic, right? So we thought that this is bad. Look at this. Okay. So not confronting measurement error in this literature is the worst thing that you can have. Now there are two ways that you can measure. You confront the literature. One is that you can confront the measurement error. One is you create, you use algorithms, estimation algorithms that take into account the possibility of measurement error. The other one is you improve the measures to actually reduce measurement error, right? So the home is actually old, as I told you. It's been around since the 1960s. What's interesting about this is a bunch of 0-1 type of questions for most of it. You can do an analysis that is called item response theory. This is telling you two things. It's telling you, Here is one information that you can get. One information is, see as I change the value of the underlying construct of interest, the probability of actually getting that task observed increases really fast. That means that this particular task is super informative about development, especially around this value here, -1. Because 50% of children with skills below -1, this value here of theta below -1, can do the test. 50% of kids above this level can also do this. So this particular test, blue, is super sensitive for children with child development at this level. Not so sensitive whether you're very high. Most children who are high in the stock of this guy here, whether they are at one or two, they're very close to, they're very likely to do that. Okay. This black line here, this black test, this black question is not as sensitive, which is good because you can, on one hand, it doesn't separate children along this, range of values here of theta, but separates children who are from this value here from children who are from this value here very well. Okay? So a good test would have this type of test, and this type of task, and this type of task, but also this type of task, because this is a much more difficult test. 50% of children who have scores, standardized scores of theta above 2, can do this test. There is a 50% chance that they will do it. There is a 50% chance that these guys here will do it. But if you are at this level here, minus 1, there is a 50% chance that you're going to do either the black or the blue. There is only like a 10% chance that you're going to be able to do this green task. That is a much more difficult test. So a perfect test would go across the distribution of an underlying concept. You would have a lot of test items. All of them would be highly indicative at one point of the distribution, and they would have very different levels of difficulty. Right? That would be like the perfect task that you, the test that you would construct. It would be informative about all people in the distribution of tests, right? In the distribution of human capital, the distribution of investment. And if you compute the information scale, you would have one test that would be very informative for guys at this point of the distribution, another task that would be very informative about guys in this point of the distribution, and so on and so forth. From basically minus 4 standard deviations to 4 standard deviations, you would have a lot of information for people. And it would be able to really construct great tests. Another way to do this is to see if you transform the score, if you look at the scores that you people have, you can go back and see, oh, there is an almost linear relationship between the scores and the standardized values of theta. Okay? Now, obviously, in the tails, things are going to become a little bit less less linear. But for most of the relationship, for most of the population out there, people who are below, people between minus 3 and 3 standard deviations from the mean, you would be able to separate who they are pretty well if you have all, if you had tests like that. So improving tests requires constructing something along these lines, which is super difficult to do. Looks easy, but looks super difficult. And once you actually have the entire test, it would be highly informative for all the guys. So the blue line is telling you, to whom is this informative? Super informative, minus 2 to 2 standard deviations below. This is the precision of the estimate that you're going to get. What are the groups of people for whom you're going to have super precise scores are going to be guys below, between minus 2 and 3 standard deviations from the mean. Okay, so constructing a test like that is really super difficult. It's, when you look at a lot of the testing agencies, what they're trying to do is they're trying to reproduce something along these lines. Okay, so that's where they spend a lot of money up to now. If you look at the home, look, I would like the home to look exactly like this, right? Many different items, all of them super informative, but very different degrees of difficulty. And what you look at what you get. What you get is you get a lot of items that are informative about guys that are between minus 3 and maybe minus 2 standard deviations below the mean, but not many items out here. You see? Not many items out here. So not really very good at separating who is. It's very good at separating who is horrible from not horrible, not so good to separate who is okay from who is great. Okay, so that's going to be, unfortunately, one of the issues with the home, which kind of explains this amount of measurement error that I'm showing to you here. Okay, because a lot of the measure that I'm going to get will not be actually informative because it's not separating great environments from not so great environments, okay? And look at this. Look at where the information is. The information is for most people is between minus 3 and minus 2 standard deviations below the mean. Almost no information if you are above minus 2, okay? and look at the transformation of the test into scores of theta, it's basically linear between -3 and 2, but anything between -3, below -3, or above -2 is super nonlinear, not really doing a great job at differentiating between these different types of households. Oh my God, I have 10 more minutes, and I have like 125 slides. It's like, this looks like my class. I mean, like the last day of my class, I present like 17 different papers. You know, I'm gonna do exactly the same today. I'm gonna wait the two last minutes. I'm gonna wait like, oh, here's all the research you need to see. Okay. So then I was curious, because we use, let's even account for measurement error. Okay, let's account for measurement error. Let's take into account the fact that the home is not perfect. But I'm not going to solve the home problem, which is I'm not going to create tasks that inform me about this part of the distribution above -2. Let's just address measurement error without addressing the underlying factor that it's actually not measuring, separating high from okay households. Would it actually lead to a bias in the technology of skill formation, even if I account for measurement error? Yes, it would. The reason why it would is because I'm actually not separating great home environments from okay home environments. What I am doing is not taking into account that for high, as I move from okay to high SES, from medium to high levels of investments, I'm not taking that into account in the estimation of the production function. So for linear production function, that wouldn't be a problem, but for the non-linear production functions, it could bias the results either way. So there is no there is no definite result whether it's going to be an upward bias or downward bias. It really depends on the functional form that you're interested in. Okay. So I showed this to you. This was done over 10 years, a period of 10 years. Part of it is the data collection was itself about over 3 years, but the data cleaning is where they actually spent a lot of time. So nowadays we have better technology. Nowadays what we do is not only we do this for one hour, we actually do this for 16 hours of the day, 2 days of the week. We actually attach something that looks like a little bit wider than this. It's about this size, but a little bit wider than this guy. So maybe like this. I wish I had one in my pocket. I do. It's actually something like this. It's a little bit thinner. It's way lighter. You guys need to use this new technology, okay? So this is actually super heavy in my pocket here. And it will do the same thing, I promise you. Now, so you attach this, and you don't need to transcribe. If you want is things like the number of adult words that were spoken around the child, not necessarily to the child, but around the child, the number of conversation turn counts between adults and children, the length of the vocalization, because again, you want to do this with children that are really young that might not actually say, "Mommy, I want a cookie." They will say, "Blah, blah, 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 blah," and the mommy will say, "No cookie for you right now." So you want to actually capture all of this data. So this automatically does that. It does that by, it's super interesting, but it does that by segmenting the audio file into recognize, first it recognizes whether this comes from an adult voice or a child voice or an electronic sound, because they have very different wavelengths. Okay, so in this case, first segments where it's coming from, and then it counts number of adult words, number of conversation turns between adults and children, and so on and so forth. There might be noise. So, for example, if the interaction is in the kitchen, sometimes people are going to be washing fruits. Then you're going to see the sound of the water. That's not going to be a word. It's going to be literally noise. Okay. So then there's silence as well. It's very similar to the model that I just told you. It's a measurement error model, but it's a different one in the sense that it's something occurs, and the null assumption is silence. But if it's not silence, if the needle is moved, then it tries different different qualifications. Is this TV or electronic sound? Is this another child? Is this a key child? And then it chooses the alternative that maximizes the likelihood. So it's very basically the model I just showed you, but unlike the model I just showed you in which the measures were continuous, this is, discrete amount of alternatives. So in our case, x and theta were continuous. In this case, I want you to think that x and theta are actually discrete random variables. Okay. So that's, and how, so how good is this? So you can actually do the following very interesting, painful exercise. You listen to 70 of these files, and then you count, and then you compare. And it's not perfect. There is some measurement error, but hopefully the measurement error here is going to be less important than the measurement error. So here's some cool data. This is from one child. So I'm showing to you the first 12 hours of this child. This is a study that we're doing in Philadelphia. So we're going to do this with lots of children in Philadelphia. This particular child, the device was turned on around 9 a.m., and it was turned off at around midnight. But red is silence, which really means that this child went to bed. So the device was not capturing anything other than the child sleeping. I'm not going to show to you child sleeping. Blue, this dark blue here, is meaningful time. Is there is someone talking so close to the child that the device understands and recognizes the words the adult person is saying. Okay? Light blue is there is some human voice, it's very far away from the child, so far away that the device doesn't recognize what the words are being said. Orange is going to be TV time. Green is going to be noise. And then red, as I said, is silence. So what's really interesting here is you can construct a time diary for interaction by looking for each child by looking at the report of the amount of meaningful time in a given day. Okay? So this is exactly what we would do with the PSID by asking parents. You can actually just compare by looking at what these numbers are going to be. What's so interesting about this is that if you sum up from basically during the day that the child was actually awake, if you sum up the numbers that you see here and the numbers that are reported by parents, parents actually tend to overreport the amount of time that they spend with children, at least in this study in Philadelphia. Okay, so here is something that is quite interesting. When we turn on the device, right in the first hour, remember observation affecting behavior, we see something like this. Either parents talk too much or parents don't talk at all. It's almost like and or they talk too much. And then they get tired of talking or then they get tired of not talking. And then we usually discard the first hour, and this is the reason why. So Hart and Risley would say this is great, but look at this. If I am talking on the telephone with my friend, is this child interaction? If I'm close to the child, it will count as adult word, but it's not going to be counted as conversation turn counts because I'm talking to a friend on the telephone. So unless I'm actually interacting with the child, conversation turn counts will not move too much. So from the perspective of the child, this was a highly interactive time, 3 p.m., between 3 p.m. and 4 p.m., but it's not as many adult words that were spoken in that time, but a lot of conversation turns, okay? So, and here's again, this is a 9-month-old child, but you can see vocalization going all over the map. Sometimes number of vocalizations, and by the way, a vocalization could be it could be ba 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 ba, it could be mommy, I want a cookie. This all would count as one vocalization. But what you see here is all of this variability over time within a day. So when you take averages for, in two-day averages, things tend to be far more stable. You wouldn't see a lot of this variability. But what's so interesting is there's a high correlation between one day and another day. It's, so you can actually account for that. Let me skip this. Oh, this is the one thing, though, is this is count data. So the kind of metrics of count data is a little bit different. You have to be taking into account some of the things that happen here. But the quality of interaction. So the Philadelphia study is done, so far we've done this measurement with very disadvantaged, extremely disadvantaged households. I want you to think that the typical household here is the Hart and Risley welfare parents. And what you see is in the national study, this is the 10th percentile of conversation turn counts, median, 90th percentile. And what you see is that a lot of my households are below the 10th percentile of conversation turn counts. Now this is, we're still looking at the data because this is constructed using a very specific model of measurement that is a little bit different from the model of measurement that was done in this national study. Okay? And the quality of quantity of interaction is, what's really interesting is if you look at 9-month-old parents in the time diary that they report, a lot of the mode would be here between close to 10,000 seconds per day. But if you look at in a 12-hour day, but if you look at the amount of interaction captured by meaningful time, there is someone so close talking to the child that that would be a lot less in terms of interaction. And what's really interesting is in our data set, we actually also do the home. Yeah, one more minute and I'll stop here. One more day and I'll stop, I promise. I know. Oh man, how many pages do I have, Chris? Sorry. Okay, so here's the thing. So remember that I told you that the home is great to separate horrible from not horrible? Here's what's going on. So if you actually look at the horrible guys in the home, this is the distribution of either quality or quantity. They're clearly to the left. Now, the medium and the high, actually you get the opposite. See, this is the problem with the home. Not so good to separate okay from not okay. So what the home says is okay, actually a lot more interaction, both in quality, measured number of conversation turn counts, as well as in quantity, number of amount of time, amount of meaningful time, than what the home actually qualifies as great. So I'm going to stop. I just want to say a few more things before I stop. A few more hours before I stop. By the way, you can also look at the emotional tone. If they're yelling, you know the decibel as well. So you can look at, is this a household in which everyone is yelling at the child, not yelling at the child, okay? What's interesting as well is, unfortunately, children that are likely to become autistic have very different sound waves from children that actually are not likely to become autistic. So you can actually use this to screen for autism. It's not perfect, but it gets some precision, and it's cheap to be done, okay? So a few things that I promised. Number one, a lot of progress is being made. So this is improving investments in children, trying to look at different ways of quantifying and qualifying the amount of parent-child interaction, but also in terms of measurement of skills. So we're moving from a world in which the measurement of skills is being done by taking tests to a measurement of skills in which things are done by actually doing tasks. Okay? It has consequences for the way we actually analyze the data. It's not an item response theory kind of analysis. It's not the type of estimator that I just described to you today, completely different. But it gives you a lot of different ways, not only separate who is high ability from who is low ability. It also tells you who is highly motivated, who is not highly motivated, just by looking at the way they're actually executing the task, which is more comparable than is based on self-report of people. And if you know SimCity, the way that this is going to progress is by looking at asking you to play a SimCity game. I'm not going to show this to you because this is going to affect your behavior when you take this test next time. A lot of people are looking at what happens with data that already exists. A lot of children actually write composition in school. We can actually look at, we have now econometric methodologies that can look at, you can look at the documents that these children actually produce and estimate how, what their level of development is, right? Some people, so right now what they were doing this for is by looking at president campaigns. So Trump has the lexical level of a 7th grade child and the grade level of a 6th grade child, okay? And another way is this reference group bias. So people are addressing this as well by looking at what is the way that we can, let's first, tell me first what you think is a highly conscientious person. then I'm gonna show you some people. You tell me this is highly conscientious, this is not so highly conscientious. So it's a way to actually standardize what people think highly conscientious is going to be. And then they're gonna mark, okay, so this guy here is even more conscientious than what she thinks is highly conscientious. I have to account for that, okay? And let me stop here because I could just keep on going. But if I were to summarize what I wanted to say is, one, inequality is increasing. A very important reason seems to be because the growth rate of skilled labor is growing at a lower rate than from what it was growing in the past. Unfortunately, the gap in investments in skills across socioeconomic groups starts to open up at really early ages. All the data that we have suggests that the inequality in investments and inequality in skills have been increasing over time, so inequality is going to be even a more important issue from now on. It's super difficult to measure skills and to measure investments. Even those imperfect measures, whatever they tell us, it still makes us scared. It seems to be the case that the literature is telling us that it's possible to change cognitive skills and non-cognitive skills by conducting interventions at very specific ages with very specific programs. And there will be a lot more research on the development of better measures of investments and better measures of not only of investments but also on skills as well. I think that that's all that I wanted to say. What I'm not going to tell you is what drives parents to invest so different in their children. That was like the other five hours of talk that I had, but Chris is not going to let me, but happy to talk to you about this topic as well if you have questions. Thank you. This is all.